For one final time in 2011, we return to the Magic City as the winners of 6 in a row, the Grambling State Tigers get ready to battle the Alabama A&M Bulldogs, who have won 8 of their last 9. The 13th annual SWAC Championship is next on ESPNU. ESPNU's presentation of college football presented by McDonald's. And welcome to the 2011 SWAC Championship game from Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama. The Grambling State Tigers, the Alabama A&M Bulldogs with the SWAC Championship on the line. Our championship storylines, Grambling State won a bit ugly, but is the representative of the SWAC West Division. Meanwhile, a three-way tie was awarded to Alabama A&M, and they represent the East Division. Hi again, everybody, alongside former NFL quarterback Jay Walker, Adam Amin on hand. A couple of teams that have two really impressive head coaches and two head coaches in Doug Williams for Grambling and Anthony Jones for Alabama A&M, whose relationship goes much further than just this football field.
Their stories are intertwined. It goes with Coach Doug Williams' big moment, Super Bowl MVP, his roommate and teammate on the Washington Redskins, current Alabama A&M head coach Anthony Jones. These two are good friends, but I can guarantee you one thing. Once that whistle blows, friendship goes out the window. It's all about who's going to walk away victorious in the SWAC championship game.
A couple of teams, and maybe not everybody expected to be here in 0-2 start for Anthony Jones' team for Alabama A&M, but they've won 8 of their last 9. A 1-4 start for Grambling State, but sure enough, they won a little ugly down the stretch to get here.
The transition was occurring down in Ruston, Louisiana, the home of Grambling State University. They had to make the change from going from a horizontal passing game to a true vertical passing game. And anytime you've got two freshman quarterbacks, the job was that much tougher for Doug Williams. Alabama A&M, they believed in themselves. They established a power running game behind their workhorse running back, Kendarius Lacy, and he was able to will the Bulldogs into the SWAC championship game.
Anthony Jones's team, Alabama A&M, has faced Grambling 3 times in the SWAC title game. Grambling has come out on top all 3 times. Grambling State won the toss. They deferred. Alabama A&M will start the day with the football. Zoltan Riazzo, second-team All-SWAC selection, will get set to kick this one away with Terrence Pride and Monterius Smith back to return for Alabama A&M, which has not had a return for a touchdown this season. Redshirt freshman Pride and a redshirt freshman in Smith. 13th annual SWAC championship game, and away we go from the Magic City. Smith from the 2. It's a solid block, but is going to get swallowed up after a 13-yard return to the 15-yard line. Alabama A&M will start with the football today. Not a necessarily explosive offense, averaging just 21 points a game, but a team that, as you mentioned, Jay, has one of the best running backs in the SWAC in Kadarius Lacy.
Yeah, Kadarius Lacy is a workhorse running back, 6 feet, 230 pounds. He's one of those rare running backs that gets stronger as the game progresses and goes on. He really wears out the opposing defenses in the second half.
And Deontay Mason is the quarterback, the junior and the transfer from Kentucky, who sprained his MCL in the regular season finale. He's been resting, trying to get healthy. He's practiced for the last week, and he takes his first snap since November the 19th. Rolling to the right on first down. He's a running quarterback, and he'll pick it up to the 22-yard line. A 6-yard gain for Deontay Mason, who didn't look as fresh as he usually does for this Alabama A&M offense, led by Lacy. Bobby Goldsby getting just his second start at the tight end position. This is an A&M offense that has had the same starting lineup for all but 3 games this year, and the offensive line has been together every single game this year. Jamal Johnson-Webb at the left tackle, first team All-SWAC. Justin Goodrich, the right guard, second team All-SWAC. Second and 4 for Mason from the 22. A handoff to Lacy. He'll pound his way to a first down across the 25 near the 30. Grambling State's defense, 4th in the SWAC, allowing just 21 points a game. Jamarcus Savage is a second team SWAC selection. They expect a little bit more out of him, though, Cliff Exuma is a name you're likely to hear all day long. One of the top defensive players in the SWAC. And this secondary, Doug Williams is joking around a little bit, but this is a secondary that has, quote, gotten away with murder at times this year. That is the weak point. The linebacking core, including Exuma, is their strong point. First and 10 from the 28-yard line. Lacy's the deep back, delayed handoff. Hole up the middle, out to the 35. Pick up 6 yards, second down.
And early on, Alabama A&M wants to establish control of the line of scrimmage. When these two teams met earlier in the season, Lacy rushed for over 150 yards, and he's well on his way today if he continues to rush for 5 or 6 yards a carry. You see the numbers on the year, 1,000 rushing yards, good old-fashioned power running back. They don't make too many more like Kadarius Lacy.
Now, he averages second most yards per game in the SWAC. He had the most yards for any running back on the opposite side for Grambling State. They had the leader in average per game in rushing. We'll talk about that when the Tigers touch the ball. Second and four. Mason rolling to the left for the right-hander. Wobbly pass and incomplete to bring up third and four. His intended target was Gialonzo Milton, with Edward Patterson as the top pass defender for the Tigers on coverage.
And we're going to have to watch Deontay Mason. His mobility really seems right to be something different. The throw right there, not in sync, out of rhythm. And during the pregame warm-ups, I was standing there with Grambling coach Doug Williams, and he was really focusing on the legs of Mason. Didn't watch one of his throws. He just wanted to see how his mobility was, and seemed as if he's moving very gingerly right now in the pocket.
He's run for over 500 yards this season, but again, coming off an MCL sprain. He said on Tuesday that he was feeling about 80%. And Doug Williams and Anthony Jones are both going to keep an eye on that today. On third and four, they go to Lacy for another first down. Two third downs, two conversions from Kadarius Lacy. Naquan Smith finally dragged him down. Pickup of 8 yards.
Right now, the offensive line for Alabama A&M is just having their way with the defensive front four for Grambling. You see the left side there. They're just looking for bodies to hit big number 67, Dub Johnson. They call him Dub. 6'5", 320 pounds. He's a load on the left side.
They call him Dub because he's rolling on 20s. He wears size 20 shoes, hence the name Dub.
Dub. Like that nickname, Dub.
They empty out the backfield for Mason on first down. Has time, finds Lacy out of the backfield, and he squirms his way into Grambling State territory after a pickup of 7 yards.
Yeah, and this is one here where you can tell where Mason's not quite comfortable in the pocket. He's looking around. You got to have the ability to make that quick shuffle in the pocket. You see the body was completely twisted, not going in the direction of the throw. Very erratic throw. Had he been able to hit Lacy right on the numbers, Lacy could have turned and picked up the first down. Mason really seems to be hobbling. If you're an A&M Bulldog fan, you've got to be hoping that as the game progresses, maybe that knee loosens up and he starts to trust it more.
Has the black brace on his left knee. Second and three, Lacy. Little hesitation, got tripped up. Otherwise, it would have been a huge gain, but he gets to the 42 and converts another first down for the Bulldogs.
And we talked in the open about the transition that took place at Grambling. Well, it wasn't on the defensive side of the ball. Clifford Yoshida was the defensive coordinator for our Broadway. He's still the defensive coordinator for Doug Williams. And right now, they just have no clue what to do in terms of stopping the run of Alabama A&M when they decide to utilize the power running game.
Grambling State, a bend but don't break defense. They've given up a ton of yards this season. They've tried to be opportunistic, but they've gotten away a little bit during this six-game win streak. It's a reverse on the move. Terrence Pride, he has a touchdown on this play this year. And he gets inside the 15-yard line before Jacardi Carter finally pushes him down. It's a gain of 31 yards for Terrence Pride to set him up in the red zone.
Great play selection by offensive coordinator Bruce Pearl for A&M. They line up in the I formation, but then they do the old reverse. Get a good seal block there by the offensive line, getting in the way. Justin Goodrich and Pride showing the athleticism needed and the speed to attack the perimeter.
Remember, on this field, you and I were here, he picked up a 17-yard touchdown against Alabama State on that very same play. As the Bulldogs set up inside the red zone, 66% on the season. Lacy, stop and go. Breaks a tackle and scores to put the Bulldogs in front.
and made it look very easy on that drive, had their way with the Tiger defense. Kadarius Lacy taking it to pay dirt for the score. Here they just spread him out, and on that drive, Lacy had 5 carries for 40 yards. But look, nobody in that second level, he knows once I can get to that area of the field, I can get into the end zone. The linebacker for Grambling overflowed to the left side. He made a cut to get to the right. Touchdown, Bulldogs.
Touchdown number 8 for Lacy. Chance Wilson has the extra point blocked. Just the second point after touchdown that the Bulldogs have failed to convert, and Grambling State comes up with a block. That could be a big play.
They're just going to go look at the penetration coming right up the middle. Good job there. One man beat this guy, swim move, and getting that right hand on it.
Big time block for Grambling State, but A&M on the board first in the SWAC championship. ESPNU College Football is presented to you by McDonald's. I'm loving it. Kadarius Lacy, 40 yards on the opening drive for Alabama A&M. An extra point block, though, for Antoine Rogers of Grambling State to keep it at a 6-0 A&M lead. To start the day in the 13th SWAC championship game, Antoine Rogers, a preseason second-team All-SWAC selection, redshirt senior from Atlanta, coming up clutch for Doug Williams' defense. And Grambling State will get set to touch the football as Chance Wilson, first team All-SWAC kicker, essentially the kicker of the year, had that blocked. And Daniel Horton, who handles the kickoffs for Alabama A&M, freshman from Huntsville, sends it away to Edward Patterson. A squib kick, and one of the up men picks it up. It's David Stuckman. Stuckman hit hard, shy of the 30-yard line. You know, we talked about Lacy and how big of a factor he's going to be. They leaned on him heavily.
Yeah, let's take a look at the adjustments made by Grambling. Take a look here. On this side, you're going to see Naquan Smith. He's the strong safety for Grambling. But take a look at Jacardi Carter. Once they get him there, Smith is there to stop the run from going to the outside. But look at the angle that Carter takes. He goes around the left side instead of going up the A-gap, leaving a wide-open hole for Lacy to make one cut, make a guy miss, and to get into the end zone. When they bring down that strong safety to funnel the run inside, inside linebackers have to stay stout.
Grambling State from the 29-yard line. Dorrance Roberts is the back for DJ Williams, the true freshman. A cut across the 30-yard line and a pickup of a couple of yards. The run went to Mario Lewis. DJ Williams, the son of Doug Williams, true freshman, over 1,000 yards this season, second in the SWAC in pass efficiency this year. We asked Doug at the beginning of the season, is there pressure on DJ? He said, yes, but not because he's my son. There's pressure on him because he's the quarterback at Grambling State University, one of the greatest HBCU programs in all of college football.
And there's also a little pressure being Doug Williams.
I imagine so. Second and 8 for DJ. Hand off to Dorrance Roberts, trying to work his way up the middle. Another 2-yard pickup. This is the Grambling State offense. Dorrance Roberts did not play in 2 of the first 3 games. They found Roberts all of a sudden, and he has become the feature back. Mario Lewis is a great receiver on the outside, right side of the offensive line. Clint Marsh, one of the leaders this year as a sophomore, second team, Sanford Banks first team. It is his second All-SWAC selection, a junior from Columbus, Georgia. Big third down here, though, for Grambling. They're second to last in conference in converting third downs. They need 6. Williams trying to evade the pressure will get wrapped up by Tillman for a loss, and it's fourth down.
Bronski Towns likes to really confuse young quarterbacks or any quarterback. And on that last one, he brought 4 down linemen with Corey Hart. You see Tim Tillman there in the starting lineup. Those front 4 were able to get the sack to get the pressure on DJ Williams. Take a look at the linebackers for Alabama A&M.
An experienced core in the middle with Fuller as well. Marcus Dozier getting the start at strong safety. Chris Irvin, who had missed a handful of games due to injury, is in as a backup safety once again for this Alabama A&M team. As Fabian Carter gets set to punt this one away on A loss of 9 to force a 4th and 15. Bobbled snap, and somehow Carter got that one away. And there is a flag down, as this one will take a friendly Tiger roll to the 25. Carter hit the deck with that pressure coming in. It is a 54-yard punt for the junior from Miami. Let's see what the penalty marker will be about. We'll get our first look at Trennis Livingston, the head referee. But again, that was a bobbled snap. Ball hit the ground when Carter picked it up, so essentially a live ball.
So you think they're probably going to pick up this flag once they talk about it, converse.
An important early penalty.
Running into the kicker on the return team. Only a 5-yard penalty. That penalty is declined. First and 10.
Doug Williams. Arguing the call. Fabian Carter getting rid of that punt, taking another look at it here. Bobbled the ball, the pressure came into him. Deron Rice called for the flag with 8:15 to go on the first. Kadarius Lacy opened up the scoring with a 12-yard touchdown run, 40 yards on Alabama A&M's opening drive. Let's take a look at the Lexus playbook, and Kadarius Lacy is heavily featured.
Well, I think it was established in the very opening drive that they're going to feed him a lot. Consider what he did last time he was in this stadium versus Alabama A&M, the game that really helped the Bulldogs control their own destiny. He was the MVP of the Magic City Classic, 38 carries in that football contest, a bunch of yards, and he pummeled the Alabama State Hornets. Look for them to use Kadarius Lacy to be the key to their offense today.
And you see what he did against Grambling all the way back on September the 24th, a 20-14 victory. Lacy had a couple of touchdowns, including the one with less than a minute to go in the fourth quarter to clinch that game, make it a 20-14 ball game. And Alabama A&M, for the first time ever, won at Grambling State. And Anthony Jones just add another notch on his belt in his time at Alabama A&M, 10th year head coach. Former Washington Redskin, also spent some time with the San Diego Chargers, won that 1987 Super Bowl, Super Bowl 22. And Deontay Mason goes back to work. One thing of concern, again, Mason coming off a sprained left knee, the MCL injury that he suffered against Prairie View A&M. He did not look very mobile, and he's a very mobile quarterback. He didn't look very mobile on that opening drive.
In pregame warm-ups, he didn't look mobile. Opening drive, he didn't look very mobile. And I mean, he still can run, but he just doesn't look comfortable. I think that's a better word, comfortable. He doesn't really trust that knee, and that's not uncommon when you're coming off an injury like that. You've got to gain the confidence to play like yourself.
From the 22, quick slant, and a strike thrown across the 40-yard line. Bobby Goldsby, just his second start of the season, just his third catch all year, and he picks up that very quick pass.
Yeah, this is what a quarterback can do on one leg, just take two steps away from the center and get rid of the ball. Great play selection by the offensive staff of Alabama A&M. When you've got a quarterback that's not feeling in the groove, give him some short three-step drops so he can find the type of rhythm to feel comfortable in which he can get involved in this football game.
From the 22 to the 42, and it also takes a little pressure off Mason to have to move around in the pocket.
Get rid of the ball quickly, you don't have to worry about avoiding the pass rush.
They'll go right back to Lacy on first down, makes the first man miss, and then he gets stuck by Brune Foster. After a gain of 6 yards, and Lacy over 50 yards already rushing on the day.
And I really like what you're seeing from Lacy. We talk about him being a power running, and I think he's added a couple wrinkles to his game, the ability to change directions. Most big running backs, they're very good north-south, very little east-west, change the direction type speed, but you saw on that last run, the ability to cut on the dime and get vertical and pick up positive yards while keeping his momentum going forward.
Second and 5. Pitch to Lacy. Good seal and into Grambling State territory. To pick up a 4, and it'll bring up a 3rd and short before Brune Foster makes another tackle on Lacy. Alabama A&M, a 7-2 record, a 3-way tiebreaker with both Alabama State and Jackson State, which is ineligible for the SWAC championship game. Essentially, It was the tiebreaker win head-to-head against Alabama State here in Birmingham at the Magic City Classic on October the 29th. There are some particulars going into the opposite division in the SWAC championship, but it came down to head-to-head. And because Alabama A&M had beaten Alabama State, they have the tiebreaker, and Anthony Jones's team, which won its only title in 2006, is back in the SWAC championship game. Cedric Goins, one of Doug Williams' linebackers, part of that great linebacking core, the redshirt sophomore from Louisiana, is down.
We mentioned earlier the strength of this Grambling defense was in their front seven. You're taking on a team that has a power running game. You're going to need their linebackers to play well. Fan of Grambling right now. You got to hope that Cedric Goins is going to be able to return to this contest, and it's just something minor.
And this is a defense that has given up a ton of yards this season. Seventh in the conference in total defense per game. And that's out of 10 teams. And that front seven really, especially during this six-game win streak, has at least helped them out and made games close. The defense has picked up. And Goins, who is a great high school athlete, baseball player, football player, track star. He's a power lifter in high school. 6'3", 200-pounder is headed off the field and might have to turn to maybe Trey Williams, a fellow sophomore who's an Alabama native, listed as Goins' backup. Might have to turn to him to step into the front seven. Doug Williams, his second stint with Grambling in his first season of his second stint. He's already picked up three SWAC championship trophies. The winner of the SWAC championship also has its head coach awarded with the Coach of the Year award in the SWAC. Third and one. Lacy reaching for that first down. Big play by David Stuckman. This is going to be very close. Lacy had already converted a couple of big third downs. Stuckman came up from the cornerback spot to try to stop Lacy before he could reach for that first down. This is going to be very close. They needed the 48.
And that's one there where Lacy needed to show just a little bit of patience. He had a pulling guard that was coming, Justin Goodrich, who was going to be his lead blocker, but he outran him to the hole and might have been stopped short. Let's take a look. Watch number 77. You're going to see him on the right side of your screen. He's coming left. If you get up close to him, there's a gap for you to pick up that yard, but Lacy chose to go outside, and in doing so, enabled the Grambling State cornerback, David Stuckman, to come up and make what could be a tackle for a loss to hold him short from the first down.
The play clock was running down, and I think Anthony Jones was wondering why there wasn't at least a measurement, and Alabama A&M is forced to use a timeout. It's Anthony Jones out on the field talking with the line judge, and I think he wanted to see whether or not that actually was short or whether it was enough for the first down. So decision time early in the first for Anthony Jones. Fourth and one for Alabama A&M. With 6 minutes to go in this first quarter, Anthony Jones having to make a decision early in this game, and his offense is coming out onto the field. We took a look at the replay, and the spot from the officiating crew did seem accurate. It's a full yard short of the 48-yard line. A&M has gone for it 22 times on fourth down this season. They're 10 for 22 and one for their last six. But they've struggled on these short yardage fourth down situations lately. Mason was hoping for that hard count.
So they called a timeout in order to go for a hard count. And now they're going to end up taking another timeout.
Or a penalty.
Yeah, that's one there. You got the ball midfield. You're up by six. The hole was there. Why not go for it? Go out there and win a championship. Take it from the other team. So often you hear coaches say, we can't gain a yard, we don't deserve to win. Well, you've got the ball at midfield. You wonder if that's one where you'll come back to think about it. Team has momentum, move the ball efficiently the first drive. Why not go ahead and put two scores on the board in the first two drives, or at least attempt to?
So they take the 5-yard delay of game penalty. And Chance Wilson will get sent to punt this one away. David Stuckman, his hands on it at the 15, and he gets hit hard. Vernon Marshall with a big stick after a 39-yard punt.
You're stuck, man. You've got to call the fair catch, Russ. You're going to get stuck, man.
The junior from right here in Birmingham.
Time it up. Give him room to make the catch. Time it up and deliver. Knock the mouthpiece out. That's how you hit him good. Watch the yellow thing go flying out. Whoop.
Like a boxer that just got leveled with a right hook.
Good, clean, legal hit by the special teams for Alabama A&M.
Vernon Marshall. Second on the team of tackles this year, sets up as a linebacker as Dorrance Roberts gets a nice hold on first down. And he'll pick up 7 yards. Tonight, after the Heisman Trophy is awarded in New York, ESPNU has continuing coverage, including reaction from analysts, coaches, and more from the winner of the prestigious award later that night on ESPNU, 3 a.m. Eastern. You can also catch the best performance of the season from this year's winner. Heisman Live tonight at 9 Eastern on ESPNU. Best Buy Theater, the site, and 5 very deserving candidates. And we'll talk to Jay Walker about his opinion on the Heisman winner later on today. 2nd and 3 from the 22 for DJ Williams, the true freshman, and the Grambling State offense, averaging 25 points a game. 4th in the SWAC this year. First throw from Williams, well off target, 3rd and 3. Lewis was his intended target, his favorite target all year.
Yeah, Mario Lewis has really emerged as a big-time wide receiver down there in Grambling, Louisiana. Great size, and when you talk to the coaches, they say he's got so much unlimited potential. Only his 2nd full season playing college football. Didn't play in high school. Basketball player in high school, but coming out there, going into a vertical passing game, what did he do this season? 17 touchdowns. He's got an affection for the end zone, as we like to say.
Leads the SWAC. 17 out of the 23 touchdowns this year. They need 3 yards. They set up the screen pass for Jeremiah Hernandez, and Williams under pressure can't connect, so just 2 total yards of offense so far for Grambling State, and the Tigers will have to punt this one away.
They're trying to set up the wide receiver screen, and no throwing lane. Good pressure there being applied by Corey Hart from Alabama A&M. Did not allow Williams to have a nice pocket to throw the ball. Incomplete pass.
O'Carter, who had a very solid punt. Again, to clarify, the penalty against Alabama A&M on Carter's last touch was not a roughing the kicker. It was running into the kicker, which is only a 5-yard penalty. It does not give you an automatic first down. Torrey Smith calls for the fair catch after a 44-yard punt. Oh, Alabama A&M takes over with a 6-0 lead. They've had a couple of key points. Remember, they've won 8 of their last 9 games, but a lot of these games came down to the final plays.
Yeah, they got off to an 0-2 start, and right when they started to gain momentum, they got into a dogfight versus Texas Southern. And on the play there after the muff punt, Rashad DeJarnette called this the play of redemption. Next time he touched the ball, he took it to the end zone for the touchdown score. Called it his play of redemption, and then Magic City Classic. Alabama State's got all the momentum. Extra point to tie, not so fast. The Bulldogs come up with a great play on special teams to keep their hopes alive, and they took care of business in advance to the SWAC Championship.
Chartavius Keith had that big block, and again, it was that win over Alabama State that gave them the head-to-head advantage and put them into the SWAC title game. It's going to be a loss for Kadarius Lacy. Good pursuit from Jamarcus Savage. The 2nd-team All-SWAC selection, it's a loss of 4.
And Savage is one of those guys, when you talk to the coaching staff, they say he's as good as he wants to be. Every now and then, he holds his talent hostage. Tremendous playmaker, tremendous athleticism. If he can increase that motor speed in terms of wanting to come out and play every single play, they say he's got what it takes to play at the next level.
Transfer from Auburn. Was 5th in the conference this year in sacks. He had 8 of them. And he forces a 2nd and 14 for Mason of the Bulldogs as he works out of the shotgun. 5-man rush for the Tigers. They set up a screen pass. Terrell Beatty gets eaten up at the 31. Cliff Exuma, one of our impact players, with a stop after a gain of 1, and it's 3rd and long for the Bulldogs.
And take a look at Cliff Exuma. See him in your top left on your screen there. He's just going to have tremendous flow to the football. Recognize it. They're trying to look him off to the left side. He goes with the right and watch him come in and shoot the gap. Good team defense by the linebacker corps. Trey Williams are forcing the runner to go inside. Next up there to make another tackle on the season.
Remember, Williams is in for the injured Goins, who came limping off the field earlier in this first quarter. 3rd and 13 for the Bulldogs. They need the 44.5-yard line. Screen set up from Ontarius Smith, and another big play for the Grambling defense. It's Edward Patterson, the cornerback, forcing a fourth down and long.
Number 20 by Tigers, Edward Patterson.
Take a good look at the recognition there. He's going to be right here on the bottom of your screen. And once he recognizes what's taking place, this is how you have to attack. Once they call your number, look at the sprint. Good start. Looked like he was firing out of the starter blocks in a track meet.
He's covering DeMario Ross and just came sprinting off of his man for the stop. And David Stuckman back to return for Grambling State. Chance Wilson got the punt away with pressure. Stuckman at the 40. Trying to switch fields. Great pursuit by Julius Williams, the Syracuse native. It's a 30-yard punt and a 2-yard loss on the return. We're talking about the Heisman Trophy being awarded in New York tonight, and I got to ask you right away, who was your pick, Jay Walk?
Oh, can I pick three? if I had to vote for it, in all honesty, I think Andrew Luck is the best college football player. Great pro potential.
Right.
Throwing all those yards without having a wide receiver. You can't name me a deep threat for him. He's got nothing but tight ends. But I will say this. Had Tyrann Mathieu not gotten suspended, he would have easily had the Heisman Trophy. It would have been his to walk away with.
3-yard pickup for Dorrance Roberts on first down for Grambling State. Kind of maybe what sticks out? Maybe about Luck or maybe about Griffin, who everybody thinks is going to win it.
Sure. I think Robert Griffin really caught America by surprise. I remember seeing him as a freshman and being teased when I thought he had Heisman Trophy type talent, but they just said, you can't win a Heisman Trophy out of Baylor University. Well, he's proved everybody wrong,
right.
And every time he had an opportunity to perform well, he did. The losses, I think his play overcame the losses. He didn't get hit as hard as most quarterbacks do from losing games when you're in a Heisman Trophy race.
Dorrance Roberts, forward progress will give him 2 yards. This will set up a 3rd and 5 for Grambling State with under 2 minutes to go in this first quarter. We'll have more on the Heisman Trophy at halftime. Chris Fowler and the Game Day crew will tell you all about it from New York.
Including your picks. You can't just put me on the spot.
Oh, okay. I'll give you a pick, too.
We'll get to that. Right now, it'd be great if Grambling can come up with the first down. They need to get one in the game. And with their defense starting to figure out what Alabama A&M is doing, if they can score and put some points on the board right now, they can really put some pressure on the Alabama A&M Bulldogs.
Kenneth Batiste is in the backfield. He was the feature back early in the season until Dorrance Roberts came alive. Williams to throw. Connects on his first pass. First completion of the day. Mario Lewis lunging for a first down. He picks up 6. The top target this season. More catches than about 3 or 4 receivers combined on this Grambling State offense.
And that was a great job of holding on to the football with your back turned to the cornerback on the outside. Mario Lewis is one of our impact players. 17 touchdowns. That's one of the best in America. Great affection for the end zone, as the legends of the SWAC like to say. Only been playing basketball football for 2 years. Tremendous upside. He'll be playing on Sundays, I think.
A high school basketball player wanted to walk on the Grambling basketball team. Here's DJ Williams running it. Picks up about 7.5 yards. Good pickup for DJ Williams, who did not rush the ball all that well this season. About 40 carries plus, but not a ton of yardage.
They're showing you some explosiveness, and I really like this call here. You got a young quarterback in there. Most often quarterbacks play better after getting hit that first time. They call his number, force him to run the ball, and then he can start playing with the confidence level.
Batiste in the backfield on 2nd and 2.
Well, they're challenging him right now to throw the ball. Middle of the field's wide open.
There's Batiste trying to work to the outside. So you probably won't have enough for the first down, and that'll take us to the end of this first quarter. Kadarius Lacy has the lone score in the first 15 minutes. 40 yards on the opening drive, including a 12-yard touchdown run to put the Bulldogs in front. It's a 6-0 score after the opening quarter of play from Birmingham, Alabama, in the 13th SWAC Championship game.
Baylor's.
ESPN News College Football presented by McDonald's. Grambling State, the Tigers taking on Alabama A&M, the Bulldogs. A 6-0 lead for Alabama A&M as we head to the second quarter. Let's take a look at our Where I'm from the United States Marine Corps, and we can take a look at how the Grambling State Tigers
got to where they're at roster-wise. They've done a really nice job recruiting outside of their home state of Louisiana. Don't forget that Doug Williams, a guy who spent a lot of time in Tampa Bay with the Buccaneers before he took over at Grambling State for his second stint.
And that's not surprising to me. I mean, give credit where credit is due. Grambling was America's black college football team for decades with Eddie Robinson, followed up by Doug Williams. They are much bigger than just the state of Louisiana, and it's a reflection on their roster of where they're from.
No, didn't have to look far for his quarterback, DJ Williams, the son of Doug, the true freshman, handing off to Dorrance Roberts, stumbling his way to a first down.
You know, the story about DJ Williams winding up at Grambling, playing for his father, is a unique one. When he committed to go to Grambling, Doug Williams was not the football coach at Grambling. He committed to play for Rod Broadway at Grambling. Rod Broadway left, went to North Carolina A&T in January, and then Grambling offered Doug the job, and that's how they ended up having the father-son combination at Grambling with DJ playing for his father.
It looked like that Roberts had enough for the first down. The line judge didn't believe so, and they're going to at least ask for a measurement here. We'll bring out the chain gang to talk about it. You're mentioning Doug's relationship with DJ. He had already signed, DJ had, before Doug came back to Grambling State. Doug signed in February as the new head coach, but DJ had an opportunity to go to Western Carolina, but he decided to go to Grambling State, and then about a month later, that's when Doug got the job offer to come back to Grambling and take over as head coach. It is going to be short after that pickup for Roberts. Doug Williams talked to us earlier in the week, talked to us yesterday. This was something he talked about with DJ's development. Needs to lose the rabbit ear, stop listening to everything. Says the one thing he hates more than anything else is Twitter. Which is unfortunate because you and I love Twitter. So
we like Twitter, but I can understand as a coach
right,
why you would not
absolutely.
Like it. It used to be a day and age where you heard about something the next day in the newspaper, where now the moment you say something about somebody, or they can hear about it just like they're on the telephone almost
right.
within 30 seconds. Social media is here. And it's here to stay.
Grambling, the most efficient fourth down team in the SWAC this year. A&M's crowd trying to make some noise on a fourth and one. Power eye formation. Roberts trying to push. Very close.
He needed 6 inches, and I thought he got back to the line of scrimmage. It was a good stand by the Alabama A&M Bulldogs.
Willie Fuller came up to try to make that stop. And Trennis Livingston putting the spot down near the 42. They needed about the 41 and a half based on where the chain is.
And you see the surge, and when it's this close, you got to think, does he get to the line of scrimmage? And I thought right there that push, he was right on it. But ooh, a little bit closer when you look at it from that angle. But you see the surge. See, I think he got 6 inches, but the Bulldogs did a good job of really pushing him back.
And boy, they spotted it a full yard, basically, short. And it's a turnover for Grambling State on down, something that has really hurt them this season. And the Bulldogs take over with excellent field position, and they have by a mile outgained Grambling State so far in this game. Had a great first quarter with Deontay Mason, a guy who's hobbling a little bit with that sprained MCL on his left leg, leaning heavily on Kadarius Lacy, his feature back. So A&M with a lead on the ball, taking over early in the second quarter. First and 10 from the 42. They'll run the reverse. Terrence Pride trying to find room, staying on his feet. He's a high school quarterback, but he can't get rid of the football. He's all the way back to the 32 as Stuart Hine ran him down. It's a loss of 10 yards.
Well, great assignment football. Don't call for the outside reverse. Antonio Leonard wraps him up. Can't bring Pride down, but Stuart Hine continuing his pursuit. Able to make the big tackle for a loss for the G-men.
Senior from Orange, California, is a junior college transfer. He's inserted himself into this starting lineup, part of that front seven. Doug Williams spoke very highly of his front four, specifically early in the season, and Hyde was a part of that. Well, Pride did not get rid of the football. He could have passed it. He has a pass for 43 yards this season against Tuskegee.
Lazy with the carry.
It's second and 20. They go back to the ground, and it's a pickup of 5 yards as Kadarius Lacy continues his big day. Over 50 yards rushing on the day for Lacy. He had the lone score in the first quarter. Remember, the blocked extra point for Grambling State keeps this at a 6-0 game.
And this is going to be an interesting play selection right now. How much confidence does Deontay Mason have in his left knee right now? Third and plus 10, 15 yards. You can't rely on a three-step drop. You've got to sit in that pocket, look comfortable, allow your receivers time to get downfield to try and complete this ball.
It's a tough third down for Mason and the Bulldogs. Five-man rush for the Tigers. Mason, not very mobile. Nearly picked off, and did Exuma hold on? They're going to say incomplete pass. Would have been the second interception of the season for Exuma. But nonetheless, it's a fourth down for Alabama A&M, and Chance Wilson will have to kick it away.
Good stop by Graham, but more importantly, a chance for them to see if Mason has the ability to run the football, and it looks like he doesn't. So I would look for defensive coordinator Cliff Yoshida to really get aggressive in his play calls, maybe start going more blitz against Mason to force him to move out of the pocket.
Exuma, the co-defensive player of the year, along with Prairie View's Adrian Hamilton. Wilson kicks it away to David Stuckman. Very short kick. Stuckman will let this one go, and it's picked up by Gialonzo Milton. He could have let that one probably bounce a little further, but decent field position for the Tigers. Cliff Exuma led the SWAC in tackles this season. He's led his team each of the last 3 years. Fourth all-time in career FCS tackles. Three-time all-SWAC selection. This is a guy that graduated this past spring with a BS in criminal justice. Born in Brooklyn and split the defensive player of the year with Adrian Hamilton. No surprise that Hamilton was on that list, but Exuma worked his way. He's worked really hard the last 3 years.
Exuma, hard worker. He's been the anchor. 130 tackles almost for the season. That's a great job. And Adrian Hamilton, 20.5 sacks this season.
Led the nation.
That's a phenomenal year that he had as well.
Prairie View nearly made it into the SWAC championship game. They lost in their regular season finale to Alabama A&M by 2 points. Prairie View had a shot to get it as well. DJ Williams from the shotgun working on first and 10 throw for Lewis, and it's second down.
Man, if you're talking about defense, you got a quarterback here next to you. Let's talk about the offensive player of the year in the SWAC conference. Casey Terrio from Jackson State University finished 10th in the nation in terms of winning the Peyton Award, which is the FCS version of the Heisman Trophy. 3,800 yards, 27 touchdowns. He had 15 interceptions. 7 of those came in one game. Phenomenal talent Terrio is, and led the Tigers to a 9-2 record on the season.
Again, ineligible for the SWAC championship game. Got a Roberts here on second down, works his way out to the 30-yard line. Does Terrio project at all? I know we were talking about this the other day.
Had an opportunity to talk to James Harris on the field before. Works for the Detroit Lions, and he throws a nice ball. And I think what's going to help him is his ability to manage his teammates. His teammates believe in him. He's got a good enough release. He throws the football well enough. He's a guy I can see getting invited to camp and sticking, maybe a practice squad guy that develops into a big-time player. He's got a nice release, and he really can read coverages.
They need the 36-yard line on this third down. DJ Williams and the Tigers trying to move the football for the first time really today. Williams getting chased, getting brought down, and there's Corey Hart for a loss of 2. One of the top players in the country, led the country in tackles for loss, 16 sacks on the year. And Corey Hart, the Marshall transfer, with a snap.
And we knew it was just a matter of time before we started calling Corey Hart's name. Good job going hard upfield and cutting underneath, changing directions. Once you see DJ Williams trying to leave the pocket, Corey Hart was there. And he's definitely an impact player. He's got 30 tackles for loss on the season and led the FCS. What a phenomenal football player Mr. Hart is.
Torrey Smith will be back to return this Fabian Carter punt. Pressure off the edge got picked up. And very short punt, and it takes a very friendly Bulldog bounce, and it will be down in midfield. Just a 20-yard kick for Carter, and great position for the Alabama A&M Bulldogs, which have a short field and a 6-point lead.
ESPNU College Football is brought to you by GEICO. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. Call Birmingham, Alabama, the Magic City, but also the Pittsburgh of the South. It's known for its iron and steel industry. You got to look at the Vulcan statue, the largest cast iron statue in the world. Thanks to the Roman god Vulcan, god of the fire and forge, for those of you wondering. Put that into the 1904 World's Fair in St. Louis. And part of this wonderful city, a beautiful backdrop here at Legion Field. Alabama A&M with a 6-point lead to start today. And very good field position. They set up at midfield. Kadarius Lacy has the lone touchdown in this game. One of the top rushers in the country, led the SWAC in yardage this year. But after that first drive where Lacy was heavily featured, they haven't been able to move the football these last three touches. They have a short field here, and Lacy has the ball. About 3 yards on first down.
Grambling State has decided to move that eighth guy close to the line of scrimmage, realizing that Mason's not going to be much of a threat to run the football. He doesn't feel comfortable passing the football, so they're crowding the line of scrimmage. And what Alabama A&M did on the last possession was try a little trick play on first down. When that backfired, it basically made them one-dimensional. But Grambling's got to figure out a way to take advantage of their defense making stops now. Opportunistic defense that the Tigers have. See if they can force or create a turnover.
Quick pass. There's Goldsby. He gets crushed from behind at the 35-yard line. A flag thrown back at the 45. Goldsby making his second start of the season at tight end, making his second catch of the day. He had two catches all year, but let's see what this penalty is about.
Yeah, on the offense, 2 men moving, 40 ball a snap, 5-yard penalty, remain second down.
Did see Montarius Smith in motion, and apparently two were in motion before the snap, so that negates the second catch for Goldsby.
Yeah, that's tough. When the strength of this team has been running the football, then you cannot afford to have those type of penalties.
I mean, forcing like longer situations.
Longer situations.
Lacey's not necessarily a big yardage back. He's a bruiser who will get you 5-6 a pop, but he's not going to get you these 15-20-yard runs on a consistent basis. Second and 12 after the penalty. Mason rolling, trying to stay mobile, and he's going to step out at the 48-yard line. He got pushed out by Jamarcus Savage. And again, Mason, a guy who runs so well, still, you can tell that I think that left knee is really bothering him.
Yes, especially when you're rolling to your right, that left knee is going to be the one you plan on to get the momentum going that direction. Normally, he would have taken off right now, but look, he cannot outrun a defensive lineman in that case there. I think that's something they're going to have to get rid of out of their play calling repertoire.
Over 500 yards rushing on the season now for Deontay Mason, but again, that part of the Alabama A&M offense may not be a factor today because of that sprained MCL. Or third and 12 for A&M. Mason rolling off balance, fourth down. And the Bulldogs on the last four drives have done nothing on offense.
And that was the adjustment we talked about. They're not going to allow Mason to stay in the pocket, so instead of bringing four rushers, they're going to bring a fifth man. Watch the linebacker core here. They're going to bring these guys here to get pressure on Mason so they can move the pocket, not allow him to get comfortable there. Once you force him out the pocket on one leg, he's not an effective passer. That's a great cut play call there by Grambling. Alabama A&M is going to have to make an adjustment to protect Deontay Mason.
David Stuckman back to return this Chance Wilson kick. Very good punt this time. He's out of bounds at the 9-yard line. Right around there is where it will be spotted. 9:29 to go in the second. Later today, ESPNU continues its coverage of the NCAA Women's Volleyball Regional Finals, 4:30 Eastern. Top-ranked Texas, the number one overall seed, beating ninth-ranked UCF.
Oh, life goes on in Texas.
Top Penn State, a young team, unable to do much this season. Grambling State unable to do much on offense so far. They set up at the 13-yard line. Give it to Roberts, who fumbles the football. Ball is still loose, and the Tigers jump back on top of it. O'Shea Hamilton, the fullback. That is the eighth fumble of the year for Dorrance Roberts. He's lost five of them, that has been the only real issue for Dorrance Roberts this season, holding on to the football.
He's an explosive running back with a quick step. So often he's small in nature, 5'9", 175 pounds. He hits the hole well, but got to hold on to that ball. That's pure upper body strength to have the ability to hold on to that football. And the Bulldog defense just could not locate it. Great job by O'Shea Hamilton.
This has been the issue for Grambling. Minus 14 in turnover margin this year. They have a six-game win streak, and in the last four games, somehow their turnover margin is minus 10, so they have been winning and winning ugly. They use a timeout here with less than 9 minutes to go in the first half. We'll take a timeout as well. A second and six coming up for DJ Williams and his Pop Doug when we come back.
The Men's College Cup Championship game. Tomorrow at 4 on ESPN.
You cannot talk about Grambling State football without talking about Eddie Robinson Sr., 1941 to 1997. 408 career victories. That record, of course, passed by Joe Paterno earlier this year. But Eddie Robinson, in college football in general, is one of the true legends of this game.
Coach Rob is one of those guys that not only was a great football coach, but he was a great American. I mean, he loved the United States of America. I've never met a Grambling player that played for Coach Robinson that didn't say he was the most influential person in their life. Didn't matter if you played for Coach Rob in the 50s or even up until the 90s. He had a tremendous influence and impact on young men.
The Eddie Robinson Trophy is up for grabs in the SWAC Championship game today. Dorrance Roberts nowhere to go on second and six. But the speedy Vernon Marshall coming up for the stop and a third down for the Tigers.
When you look at the A&M defense, they're very aggressive, but they're not big at all. Very small defensive line. Talk about Vernon Marshall playing outside linebacker, 5'11", 190 pounds, but the key to their defense is their defensive speed. They are very fast, which makes them very opportunistic. And that just basically equates to the running backs aren't used to getting hit so quickly once they touch the football.
Grambling State is 1-for-5 on third down. Need to get to the 23-yard line. A pass is dropped, and that'll bring up a fourth down. Van Phillips, a converted tight end, grad student from Alabama, cannot hold on, and Grambling State will have to get rid of the football.
And that was a good throw by DJ Williams. Van Phillips kind of short-armed that ball there. When you're the senior wide receiver and you've got a freshman quarterback that's trying to find his groove, you got to make yourself a bigger target, not a smaller target. Phillips there with the drop ball.
Well, punt coming up to Torrey Smith, a Birmingham native. Fabian Carter will kick this one away. And the fourth three and out for Grambling State today on five drives. Left-footed Miami native. And at the 50-yard line is where Alabama A&M will set up as Smith calls for the fair catch. ESPN News coverage right down the road for the Men's College Cup continuing tomorrow at 4 Eastern. How about this Cinderella run for the Charlotte 49ers? They'll take on top-ranked North Carolina in the championship match. The NCAA Men's College Cup presented by Enterprise Rent-A-Car on ESPNU tomorrow. Rob Stone, Taylor Twelman will be with you. They were going deep into the night in Hoover, Alabama, right down the road from Legion Field. Couple of double overtime matches that both ended in penalty kicks last night. North Carolina knocking off UCLA, and how about Charlotte knocking off number 2 Creighton to continue that magical run towards the NCAA College Cup. We'll talk more about that. You'll hear more about it at halftime. From the 50, Kadarius Lacy has a hole.
Lacy on the carry.
He's got a first down to the 39. Longest run of the day as Brune Foster dragged him down.
Well, we saw earlier on this play where Lacy did not wait for his pulling guard. Watch the patience this time he shows as we run this play. The guard is there pulling, not quite as quick, but watch him set him up, give him a push, then cut vertically up the hole there. Showing that patience, he was rewarded with a big play.
Lacy had that great first drive. A&M hasn't done anything since that first drive where Lacy scored from 12 yards out. They go right back to Lacy, trying to cut back, and good pursuit from the Grambling State defense. Trey Williams came in for an injured player. Center Goins in the first quarter, making the stop. This is what has happened for A&M since that first drive. they had their worst field position of the day and scored a touchdown. Their field position has gotten better all day, and they've done nothing.
Sometimes you got to play the game on the field. The numbers don't make sense. But the thing I do like about Alabama A&M right now is they're starting to feed Lacy.
Right.
Don't play with the passing game until Grambling absolutely stuffs your running game.
And remember, we saw Grambling put a little bit more pressure on Mason to try to force him to get out of the pocket. Now they'll go right back to Lacy again. And this is a Grambling State defense that has done well trying to stop big players this season. David Smith with the stop after a gain of one, trying to move quickly to the football. But another Grambling State Tiger is down. Looks like it may be Jamarcus Savage, the second team all SWAC selection. We talked about earlier in this game, Doug Williams so high on Savage's potential, wanted a little bit more from him in this SWAC championship game.
The key to being a defensive end, a great defensive lineman, is that motor. You hear the term used all the time, motor. What does that mean? That means every time the ball snaps, you're trying to make a play. So often an average defensive lineman will get caught up in the wash, give you a half effort on a pass rush, and maybe rush hard at the quarterback one out of every four snaps. Well, those that have that high energy, high motor guys, every single play, they're always trying to create a turnover.
And Kadarius Lacy on that run, setting an Alabama A&M record, nearly 1,200 yards rushing on the season. It was only a matter of time before Lacy set it. Sure enough, Lacy's got it.
Wow. Good job by Kadarius Lacy. They've had some good ones that have come through Alabama A&M. Thinking about the Freddie Lesters and the Luke.
On third and six, Mason will fire, has an open man, and a first down to Terrence Pride. He breaks a tackle. He's into the end zone.
Alluded to the weakness of the Grambling State defense being in that secondary. If you can get wide receivers into the secondary, they have been suspect at times this year. Fake the run, give a quick pump. All of a sudden, wide receiver running free in the secondary. Poor job of tackling, poor angles of pursuit by the Tigers, and touchdown, Alabama A&M.
Stuckman was in pursuit. Smith was in pursuit. Neither could bring him down from 36 yards out. Pride scores, and Wilson misses his second extra point of the day. One block and one banged off the upright. He'd missed one all year. He's missed two today. But number two scores his third touchdown of the year from 36 yards out. Alabama A&M had struggled moving the football since that first drive. Pride moving well into the end zone for a 12-point lead. A redshirt freshman from Harvest, Alabama, went to Sparkman High School and works his way into the end zone on a 36-yard catch, tackle break, and run. Two missed extra points, though, for Alabama A&M. One block from Grambling and one off the upright from Chance Wilson, the top kicker in the SWAC. But the Bulldogs bring in the band and have a 12-0 lead. There is Wilson, the top kicker in the SWAC this season. 1 point after all years. Had two miscues today.
And those are looming large. Just imagine if Grambling can score a touchdown, and your lead is only 5 points,
right,
compared to having that comfortable touchdown lead. They've really got to hope that doesn't come back to haunt them, and they're putting a lot of pressure on their defense to keep playing at a very high level.
David Stuckman back to return. Daniel Horton kicks it away. This will be Patterson from the 13. Solid return out to the 29-yard line. That's where Grambling State will set up. Down 12, under 6 minutes to go here in the first half. Trying to get something going. DJ Williams and this Tiger offense. These two teams squared off on September the 20th and 24th. It was a 0-0 game at halftime when those teams squared off. Grambling got close. They had it at a tie game at one point, scoring 14 in the second half. But it was Kadarius Lacy's second touchdown of that game in the final minute that gave Alabama A&M a 20-14 victory. Williams, 1 for 5 so far, passing for just 6 yards. He's been sacked twice. He sets out for a home run ball. into double coverage, and that'll bring up the second down. Mario Lewis, the top target, 50 catches this season, could not haul it in. It's second down. Viron Brown is the offensive coordinator in his first season. That's the change, going from a spread option to a multi-set pro-style offense. Viron Brown tasked with that from Doug Williams.
And Coach Brown played for Doug Williams at Grambling, went and got some seasoning around some of the different schools in the SWAC conference, and came back to Grambling. That's home for him, as so many G-men often do. And you can tell they are starting to stretch the field a little bit, throwing the ball downfield, going deep, trying to allow Mario Lewis to make a play to try and jumpstart this offense.
Just been outgained by 125 yards so far. Williams setting up on second down. Strong throw. May not have gone to his intended man, but Bakari Maxwell comes out with the catch near midfield. Two men in the area. Maxwell said, look what I found, for 19 yards.
Yeah, he was definitely throwing the ball to the slot wide receiver Hernandez, and you see him miss high on the throw. But Maxwell, recognizing that, he's on the clear out route, and he actually came from out of bounds in to make that catch there.
Well, the clock will run once again from the 48-yard line.
Yeah, I think they're going
to. They may have to take a look at that.
Take a look.
If you step out of bounds and you're the first one to touch the football coming back from out of bounds, that is illegal touching.
And then something to note here is this is going to be the very first time the SWAC conference is going to utilize a replay. You see him right there. He's out of bounds right there, and you cannot be the first player to come back in and touch the football. But of note, in the SWAC championship, they will review this play for the first time this season. And if you're Alabama A&M, you got to be thankful for the use of instant replay, because we're pretty sure this is coming back.
The MEAC was the only FCS conference to use instant replay at every televised game this year. The SWAC doing it for the championship game.
And this may be a prelude to what they want to do for next season. I wouldn't be surprised if all the SWAC television games are instant replay.
Yeah, another look. Hernandez, the intended target. Maxwell came in along the sideline to make the catch, but he clearly stepped out from a couple of our looks we saw it.
And that's one, if you're Bakari Maxwell, you're the clear-out guy. You cannot get jammed out of bounds. Defensive backs win if they force you into the sideline.
Judson Mitchell is the field judge. Jesse Harris, the line judge. Both came in to help Trentis Livingston make the call. And you see that he's written it down and usually a sign that they will reverse it. And that will likely be the call here. And these are the replay rules. You can reverse a call, which means there's indisputable video evidence to overturn the original ruling on the field. Call confirm means that the original ruling was correct. And the play stands means there's not enough indisputable video evidence to overturn any call. Trentis Livingston will likely reverse this call, clearly showing that Maxwell stepped out and was the first one to touch the football when he came back in bounds.
After further review, the receiver went out of bounds on his own, was the first to touch the ball. It'll be also a loss of down, third down. The line of game will be the 29-yard line of Grambling State.
Well, big penalty here. The SWAC using replay for the first time. You see the first reverse call. Well, it is a loss of a down, and back to the 29-yard line they'll go.
So often you'll hear some criticism on the use of instant replay, and I'm a big fan of it. If it's going to help get the call right, then that's what it's all about. You work so hard, you want to be rewarded when you do things right, and you don't want other teams to gain unfair advantages because of human error. So good job. Hats off to the SWAC Conference and Commissioner Dewar Sharp.
It brings up a very important third down. They need the 39-yard line. Williams will pass again. Pressure coming. Picked off at the line of scrimmage. Corey Hart.
Interception by number 95, Corey Hart.
Fighting for the football at the bottom of the pile with Benny Peoples, but Hart with the pick.
His first of the season, the redshirt senior from Alabama, has come up with a big turnover, a takeaway for A&M.
Watch the recognition by Corey Hart, then the athleticism on the left side of your screen to make the one-handed interception. Gets that left hand up in the air, pulls it in for the interception. We talked about him being a tremendous playmaker behind the line of scrimmage. Well, now he's showing he can drop back in coverage. Great recognition and pulls in the interception. Huge play for the Bulldogs.
Just the 12th interception this season for Alabama A&M. Five of them have come against Grambling State. And that turnover margin continues to grow. They go back to Pride. He picked up a big run on this reverse in the first quarter. He gets dragged down by Naquan Smith after a gain of four.
And in the contest between these two schools early in the year, Grambling State turned over the football eight times in their losing effort at home versus Alabama A&M. You turn over the football, probably not going to win a lot of football games.
Four interceptions in that game, two from DJ Williams, two from his backup, Frank Rivers. They played about equal time this year. And this continues to be a problem, not only all season, but even during this win streak and now into this game. Minus 11 turnover margin the last five games. Delayed handoff. Lacy swallowed up at the 18-yard line. No gain. That'll bring up a third down. Naquan Smith, the safety, and Cliff Exuma, the co-defensive player of the year, teaming up for the stop.
And that's back-to-back plays. We've called the name of Naquan Smith coming up from that safety position. So that lets you know they're committed to trying to stop the running game from Alabama A&M. Crowd in the line of scrimmage. Naquan Smith playing strong safety like you're supposed to. Run stuffer.
And Doug Williams said yesterday to us that Naquan Smith probably deserves more credit than the secondary overall has gotten this year. Again, that's been the weak point, but Smith has been solid. Trying to be here as well on a third and six. Mason wanted to throw quick, not an open man there. One-on-one coverage outside, and a fourth down coming up. Gialonzo Milton was covered well.
What a big stop by Grambling. Turning the ball over there, forcing Alabama A&M to three plays in out. Even if they convert this field goal, it's only a 15-point lead, which means two touchdowns and a two-point conversion. You're right back in things. And for an offense that has not given them any help at all, this Tiger defense has showed some flashes of being that bend but not break defense that we discussed earlier.
Chance Wilson has made each of his last six field goals. His last miss was against Grambling State on September the 24th. He slices one home from 34 yards, and it's a 15-0 Bulldog lead. A&M turns an interception into 3 points. Chance Wilson has made seven straight. 3:52 left in the first half, and coming up on the State Farm Halftime Report, we'll have a Heisman Trophy preview with Chris Fowler and the gang, 2011 Men's Soccer Championship preview, and the 2011 Women's Volleyball preview, which you'll see later tonight. And, of course, we'll have stats and highlights from our opening half of play in the 13th annual SWAC Championship game. It's all coming up at halftime of the State Farm Halftime Report. It's Anthony Jones' team is a 15-0 lead.
Well, before we hear from the halftime crew and everybody else, and you start to take their scouting report, give me your Heisman Trophy picks there, Adam.
You know, I'm going to steal from Chris and the guys. Andrew Luck, I think, was the most consistent offensive player. I'm a big fan of wow factor. I think a lot of guys talk about the wow factor.
RG3.
Bar none, especially down the stretch of the season, and I may be falling into the trap of looking at those last few games, but RG3 really did it for me these last 3-4 weeks. Just so impressive with everything he did. Edward Patterson from the 8-yard line. Grambling being shut out here in the first half. Patterson giving him a good return out near the 32-yard line.
I'll tell you something to note right now. This is a very critical series right now for DJ Williams.
Right.
Earlier in the season, he got banged up a little bit, tweaked an ankle. Backup quarterback Frank Rivers came in and played very well. And so they had a little bit of a quarterback controversy going for a while. And Rivers gave him a spark that they needed. And Doug Williams said that DJ learned from being on the bench. But if he doesn't get things going right now, and I think if they go into halftime without any points on the board, then you may see Frank Rivers, the local kid from right here in Fairfield, Alabama, which is a in Birmingham, he may get called. So it's time for DJ Williams to step up and make some big plays right now.
And he'll pass again out of the shotgun. Home run ball. Lewis down the field. Second down.
It was there. I mean, that's what you want there. That's the matchup. Great play selection. Your go-to wide receiver, if you get the ball near him, you know he's going to do it. You see, Louis, look at the effort. This is the basketball player laying out. That's one there just a couple yards short from turning this football game around with the momentum.
They found him on the intramural football field. He wanted to walk on as a basketball player at Grambling State. Before his junior year, they found him playing intramural football. Said, why don't you come on out for the team? Sure enough, he did. He became a 50-catch guy this season and still has eligibility remaining. He's a senior this year. Kenneth Batiste gets the handoff, has a big hole for a first down out near midfield for the Tigers. It's a 19-yard run for Kenneth Batiste, the Louisiana native.
Well, take a look at the left guard here on the block here, Ashton Green. And you're going to see a nice little crease you're going to get right there. Once he goes down inside, oh, you seal him down that far. Great job. Batiste had a wide open lane to run through.
Williams setting up the screen pass into a very tight window for Lewis. Second down. And they're looking at this Williams
one,
to pass a little more.
Yeah, and this is one, if you're the quarterback and you see this much confusion, throw the ball in the ground or throw it away. You got to get rid of it. This is the wide receiver screen. You tell me, is there a throwing lane to get this football on the right side? Too much confusion, too many bodies. If you don't see that guy that's 4 yards away from you and you can't almost hand the ball off to him, you've got to go someplace else with the football and realize the defense has called your number. And that's something where, as a freshman, you'll learn to just get rid of the football and live to fight another day.
Corey Hart nearly got his hands on that one as well. He picked off the last pass on the last drive for Williams, who runs on second down and moves into Alabama A&M territory with a 6-yard gain that'll bring up a much more manageable third down for Williams and the Tigers with 3 minutes to go in the half.
Picking up positive yardage always helps third manageable situation. Right now, I've noticed a mismatch problem that Grambling may be able to exploit. Last time I saw Mario Lewis on the field, he was lined up against Vernon Marshall, who's an outside linebacker playing the cornerback position down on the bottom of your screen. You've got one-on-one with your playmaker taking on the linebacker. Go get him.
That is Marshall covering Lewis, bottom of the screen, third and four. Another confident throw this time near the 30, and it's picked up by Bakari Maxwell, a 14-yard pickup on third down to move the chains.
Good pocket there by Grambling, and now they're starting to step on the gas pedal, trying to do a little bit of hurry-up offense. They like the look they see.
Batiste spins away from Willie Fuller, who would eventually push him down, but maybe got an extra yard or two. Batiste with 5 yards to set up second and five. Remember, Grambling gets the ball back to start the second half. This would be a huge score to pick up late in this first half. Batiste stays in the backfield with Williams, the freshman. A&M bringing the heat. Williams gets rid of it. Nobody was really looking for it, but a flag is thrown late. Willie Fuller brought in a big hit on DJ Williams.
And he disrupted the whole play. He forced Williams to throw the ball sooner than he would have liked, and you see it there. Williams does a good job of just getting rid of the football, but because he threw it so soon, the intended wide receiver did not even know the ball had been thrown, was in the air, and didn't recognize it.
Well, Willie Fuller, the first team All SWAC selection, Georgia native.
Now tell me, is this a pass interference if the wide receiver doesn't even know the ball's coming to him? That's the big hit. Now watch the end. The wide receiver's looking. He doesn't see the ball. He's just looking, looking, looking. The ball was thrown on the inside. They called Clarence Morris for pass interference against Damian Jefferson, but Jefferson did not see the football there. That's a tough call.
Let's take a look at what Grambling State has done in the red zone this season. Brought to you by Verizon, the most efficient team. They've had the fewest opportunities, only 24 red zone chances, but bar none, the most efficient team. Alabama A&M's defense has been very good. Williams, the fade. Lewis, overthrown. Second down.
Wow, you talk about separation. Mario Lewis, bump and run. Don't play bump and run against a point guard. Lewis is going to separate cleanly. Look at all that room. That's great separation, but watch him go into the band. Hey, it's not halftime yet.
Well, he beat Derek Harris again. Harris has been beaten a couple of times. Remember the outstretched arms of Lewis on that diving attempt that was just overthrown.
I go back to him. I mean, the way he spun him like a top there, clearly Harris cannot stay with him one-on-one.
They love him in the red zone. They'll go to Batiste on the ground to the 10. Pickup of a yard. It will be 3rd and 9. They don't necessarily need the end zone, but it's about as close to it as you can get. And a couple of big plays for Grambling State down the stretch of this first half. Try to get on the board against A&M, which shut Grambling out in the first half back on September the 24th. That was a 0-0 game at halftime. And DJ Williams do it on third down. Just 2 for 8 today, the true freshman.
That's Lewis right there. He's got the whole left side of the field.
Fires end zone. Jefferson can't hang on. Rico Porch on the coverage. Another first team SWAC selection, bringing up a fourth down for Grambling State.
So they tried to go with the one-on-one, but he does not do a good job of coming underneath. No separation there. Good coverage by Rico Porch.
Four interceptions this season for the Alabama native Porch to lead the club. Now Zoltan Riazzo, the second team All-SWAC selection, the California junior college transfer, made 4 of his last 5. Chip shot to put the Tigers on the board from 27 yards out. Doug Williams' team moves down the field but cannot connect with a couple of receivers. And just 3 points for the Tigers, who do crack the scoreboard with 62 seconds to go in the first half.
Yeah, they had some opportunities there. Overthrows to their play, their big play wide receiver, Mario Lewis. If they just hit him once in stride when he was open, would have been a touchdown to put 7 points on the board instead of just the 3. But at this point, considering the way that Grambling started off this football game, Doug Williams is happy just to get a drive and maintain a drive and walk away with any type of points on the board.
It'll be interesting to see if DJ Williams indeed does start the second half for Doug Williams. And finally did put something together offensively, moving the football better. 59 yards after really futility the first half dozen drives. Doug Williams said the year that DJ spent at Hargrave Academy, Hargrave Military Academy in Virginia, really did a number for him to at least work on his development. So he is a true freshman in college, but he did have that year of experience at least to get on the same level as the sophomore Frank Rivers. That's why they kind of split that time about equally this year, with Williams making a majority of the starts.
And he needed physically. I mean, you know, you can see him now, 6'4", 195 pounds. When he's done playing the Grambling, he's going to weigh 210 pounds,
boy, right.
215. He'll have a nice frame, but right now he's kind of wiry. And I believe that extra year helped him mature physically.
Pride having to work back to the 5 on a line drive from Riazzo. Has a seam. Pride into the open field. Breaks another tackle and gets hit hard at the 37-yard line. But an excellent return for Terrence Pride, who continues to be very elusive in just about every facet of the offense. Special teams now, too.
And Pride's a guy that doesn't have that 4-3 burner speed that you want, but he's a guy that you can't arm tackle to bring him down. Great vision to see. Once you try and tackle him there with your arms, high shoulder pads, he'll get away from that. He's always moving. He's just what you call a good old-fashioned football player. Doesn't matter what you clock him in the 40-yard dash, but rarely will you catch him on the football field.
Well, let's see if A&M, which needs to go 68 yards for a touchdown, they're not the most explosive big play offense, but they can grind it out. They've got 50 seconds and 2 timeouts to try to do it. Kadarius Lacy.
Lacy on the carry.
Across the 40-yard line to the 43. Brune Foster, the Safety coming up, making a stop after a half dozen. 39 seconds to go. The clock will continue to move.
Brunei Foster just got in the way on this one here. You're going to see Lacey hurdle somebody. Now watch him look for somebody to hit. Oh, okay, Jew Foster, boom, get off me. He just laid his body there to get in the way.
Foster did just enough just to keep enough. Lacey from continuing to move. Anthony Jones does not use one of his two timeouts here. Second and four. He loaded up. They pitch to Lacey. Good block on the outside from Brian Nelson. Lacey will get close to a first down, and that's going to take us to the end of this first half. Well, Alabama A&M trying to win its second SWAC championship in the divisional play era.
At the end of the first
trying to beat Grambling State in the title game for the first time in four tries. From Birmingham, Alabama, it's an A&M lead of 15-3. We'll be back with our State Farm halftime report after these messages. You're watching ESPNU's College Football presented by McDonald's and the 13th annual SWAC Championship game. Alabama A&M with a 15-3 halftime lead from Birmingham, Alabama and Legion Field. Alongside former NFL quarterback Jay Walker, Adam Amin on hand. We're back inside the broadcast with that Legion Field. Not a lot of turnovers from Grambling State. They only turned the ball over once, but an inability to move the football. And when Alabama A&M didn't move the football, their defense really stepped up. So A&M played a really solid first half.
They came out and established their game plan, what they want to do, run the ball with Kadarius Lacey and then allow their defense to attack the freshman quarterback and DJ Williams, right, limiting the Tigers to just four first downs in the first half. DJ Williams is just 2 of 13 throwing the football. He has not found his groove, and A&M is in full control.
And Kadarius Lacey did a really solid job taking some pressure off the somewhat hobbled Deontay Mason of Alabama A&M as well. Let's take a look at how A&M got to a better state. And it's brought to you by State Farm.
And if you're Grambling, you need to take a look at this game plan. Find out where Corey Hart is on the football field at all times. You see him there with the sack, the pressure. Then he's dropping back into coverage, recognizing where you're trying to go with the football with the interception. Corey Hart's been the best football player on the field defensively for Alabama A&M all season long. He's continuing to wreak damage here today versus Grambling State.
Take a look at our first half stats. The rushing game with Kadarius Lacey pretty much in balance. Terrence Pride had a really solid first half. The wide receiver for A&M did it on special teams and helped out Deontay Mason, his quarterback.
Yeah, helping him out with the end of rounds and with the running game. He's really been a great complement to Lacey. And for Grambling State, just less than 100 yards in the first half. Good time of possession. Turnovers haven't hurt them that much, but they've got to figure out a way to maintain a long drive down the field and ultimately get into the end zone.
It's a dozen-point lead for Alabama A&M after the first 30 minutes of play. We'll have plenty more from Legion Field at Birmingham, Alabama, when we come back after this.
State Farm. In a
43. Back at Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama, Alabama A&M with a 15-3 halftime lead in the SWAC championship game as we get set for half number two. And the members of the 2011 SWAC Hall of Fame from multiple sports and the football players, famous ones there. Richard Stebbins is in the class as well. Lonnie Walker is in the class, and he actually had a chance to catch up with some of these guys as well.
And one thing you know about legends is it's a great honor for them to be honored right now, because I've been knowing Richard Stebbins and Lonnie Walker for a long time. They've always told me how great they were. Now, as a young fella growing up, I can tell they weren't lying. They deserve it. And congratulations to that great group.
Absolutely.
Lewis Tillman, fantastic football player, Wilbert Ellis, and Jesse L. Harris.
Five of the six members and six members of the Hall of Fame class.
Yeah, look at Lewis Tillman. He looks good. Like, he can still get out there and run some routes for you.
I think so, man.
Sporting the Jackson, the Letterman jacket, it still fits. That's a badge of honor.
your Howard Letterman jacket.
Busting at the scene.
Alabama A&M, very impressive on the ground early in this ball game. Let's take a look at some of our first half highlights for Alabama A&M with that 12-point lead. You knew Kadarius Lacey was going to get the ball early and get the ball to often.
They crank that diesel and keep it going. You see him going there just trucking through the Tiger defense on that first drive, very impressive. But the extra point that was blocked, that could come into play because they did miss one early, later on. But then you saw Terrence Pride there in the round and also got a touchdown reception. But You got to think, sooner or later, are these miscues on special teams going to take effect? And they could have a factor at the end of this football game.
Kadarius Lacy, a very solid first half rushing the football. 74 yards and a touchdown on the ground. You mentioned Terrence Pride, did it in multiple ways on special teams, on the rushing game. Caught a couple of passes, including that 36-yard touchdown as well from Deontay Mason. Give me a kind of a grade on Deontay Mason, considering that he's got that left knee injury and he's still trying to get back to 100%.
He's gone the right places with the football. Clearly cannot protect himself in the pocket. Running is out of the question, but they were able to get the most out of their pre-snap read, sticking a couple passes in there to their tight end, just off of alignment, then going the right place with the football. 5 of 9, 62 yards, 1 touchdown. On paper, doesn't look great, but when you talk about what he's playing and the conditions he's playing under, I think he's done a stand-up job.
Doug Williams, 3 SWAC titles. Anthony Jones has 1 as well. This is the history of the SWAC championship game. They went to divisional play in 1999. This is a championship that goes back to the 1920s, though. They went to divisional play in 99. This is the 13th game. See, those 3 matchups, Doug Williams has won all 3 against Alabama A&M, including a couple against Anthony Jones.
And that chart right there, that's telling you how this conference has really changed, how the realignment power structure has gone. It used to be the Louisiana school, Southern and Grambling, clearly dominating. They were rotating, playing in this game. But then Prairie View came along, and so did the Texas schools. They started getting involved in the act. And on the eastern side of the division, it's pretty much been Jackson State, Alabama A&M rotating on a pretty regular basis, with Alabama State making appearances too and winning.
Last season, it was Texas Southern beating Alabama State in a very low-scoring game and a very tight game. It was 11-6. This is a game, and you saw the scores, that has a history of being very tight. It is a 2-score game right now, but it's only a 12-point lead. As Daniel Horton gets set to kick off, the field goal at the end of the first half for both teams. Edward Patterson, David Stuckman back to return, but the squibber will be grabbed by Stuckman. Eventually, at the 11. Stuckman having to work backwards, not much of a return at all. Great pursuit from the Alabama A&M kick unit. Long field to work with is Chartavius Keith, who had that extra point block back in the Magic City Classic. Comes up with a nice special teams play here. And DJ Williams did not have a very nice first half throwing the football.
He did not, but let's give credit where credit is due. The last drive of the first half for the Grambling State Tigers, he did move the team down the field, put some points on the board, and I think it's because of that last spark of momentum he showed at the end of the first half why they call his number in the second half, to see if he can continue upon that.
Remember, they had 59 yards on their last possession. On their first 6 drives, just 30 yards. First and 10, Dorrance Roberts ducking ahead, getting to the 19-yard line. Pick up a 5. Vernon Marshall came up to make the hit, as did Rico Porch. Roberts, again, a guy who came out of nowhere to really help a rushing attack that was searching for a feature back. Roberts didn't play in 2 of the first 3 games of this season.
When you talk to the coaches, they blamed it on themselves. They said, why didn't we see this spark that he missed? And they just said, he's just a gamer, not a practice player. But when the lights go on game time, he can come through in a big way.
They go to Roberts again on 2nd and 5, weaving his way close to the first down marker and getting past it, all the way past the 30-yard line before he's finally pushed back. It's a solid 13-yard gain to move the chains for Dorrance Roberts. Eddie Robinson had a great quote. Doug Williams used it to talk about Dorrance Roberts. Looks like hamburger, plays like steak.
Plays like steak, and you can tell. Look at the shiftiness there, with the ability to change directions 3 times during that run, and that wherewithal you have to have at the running back position to never give up at the end of the play. Small frame, 5'9", 175 pounds, but like I said, he plays like a steak.
He rushed for nearly 200 yards against Alabama A&M and a touchdown when these 2 teams met in late September. Moves it out to the 32-yard line. Williams rolling, pressure coming, hard, wraps him up and swings him down at the 20. Another sack for Corey Hart. It's a loss of 10.
Well, we talked about learning where Corey Hart is. Where is he coming from in this game if you want to have success against this Alabama A&M defense? Corey Hart is going to bring the pressure right there, lined up on the hash mark, playing the traditional defensive end position. You don't leave their best football player unblocked, even if it is a naked bootleg. And if you're the quarterback and he's going to be unblocked, last man on the line of scrimmage, get that head around quickly, know where he is so you can get rid of that football and not take a sack.
Third time that Williams has been sacked today. A couple for Hart, who has lined up on the left and right sides just about equally today. Spread it out for Williams, taking a shot, picked off, but a flag is thrown. Rico Porch coming up with the interception, but there was a lot of contact with Desmond Spivey, who is also a receiver down the field.
I'm pretty sure it's got to be offensive pass interference. Desmond Spivey grabbed the defensive back and just threw him to the ground while Porch was coming over to make the interception.
For Porch, that would be his team-leading fifth interception. He was fourth in the SWAC this year in picks. Williams, who'd really been solid in decision-making the last couple of games, he had only two interceptions total in the last two games. He's got two today if this one stands. Trentis Livingston tells us about it.
Pass interference, defense, number 29. 15-yard penalty, automatic, first down.
And it's Clarence Morris, another pass interference penalty. Remember, he was kind of a lot of checking going on with Spivey on the sideline.
Morris is going to get thrown to the ground on your left side there. You'll see he's on the ground. He got slung to the ground while Porch came over and made the interception now. And then you see how did Williams have protection? They sent some extra guys over there. Put three blockers on one defensive end. That's respecting Corey Hart to the utmost.
And that's two all-SWAC selections in that triple team on Corey Hart. But the penalty on Morris makes a big impact. It puts it back at the 32 and gives Williams a first and 10 as he gives it to Dorrance Roberts. And he will get stacked up after maybe a very short gain. Roberts, who again fumbled the football on the first down, making sure he holds on to it this time.
They'll protect the football there. You know, right now, if you're Grambling on the offensive side, Byron Brown, what do? You try and throw the football, your quarterback's not able to connect. Your running game has shown sparks, but I think Alabama A&M seems pretty content right now to play very conservative defense, keep everything in front of them. I still say sooner or later they've got to get the matchup. When you've got Mario Lewis lined up against Vernon Marshall, a converted linebacker, give him a chance to make a play.
He's on the field side. Side with more space. Big pop as Roberts takes it on second and 8 for a gain of 3. Good hit put on by Tim Tillman and Denzel Cotton. Tillman had a very good first half as well. Tillman, a guy who's forced 6 fumbles in his 19-game career. That's already second most forced fumbles all time in SWAC history.
That's a lot of forced fumbles. That just means he brings a little extra thud to the pile when he gets there to make the tackle.
3 sacks this year as well, Tillman, the Georgia native. We'll line up on a 3rd and 5. Kenneth Batiste in the backfield, along with Williams. 4 wide receiver set. Williams looking. Williams running. Flag is thrown. Williams will be short of the first down. There is Tillman on cue, but a flag thrown to the offensive backfield. See if this might be a holding penalty as well. I imagine they declined it.
Holding. On the offense, number 70. That penalty is declined. Be 4th down.
Sure enough, Clint Marsh called for the holding penalty. The sophomore from Mobile.
Good, Clint Marsh. Guard that you see. Turned his back to him there. Kind of spinning around there.
And Melvin Payne, the transfer from Ohio. Got a work inside on Marsh. And penalty indeed declined, so 4th and 3, and Montarius Smith back to return this Fabian Carter kick. Left footer. A solid kick. And this one's going to land in the end zone, and Alabama A&M will have a touch of the football here in the second half from the 20-yard line.
Provocative, unexpected,
come on, baby. Oh, yeah. start bringing the flavor, brought to you by McDonald's. That's what's at stake. Beautiful Eddie Robinson Trophy on the line of the 13th SWAC Championship game. ESPN's presentation of college football on ESPNU, presented by McDonald's.
Yeah, now you're cool enough, guys. Is it bringing the flavor, or is it bringing the flavor?
The flavor? I don't really have the gusto.
I think it's the flavor.
The flavor. Bringing the flavor, brought to you by McDonald's. Mason from the 20-yard line. We'll go to the fullback, Brian Nelson. Just his third carry of the season. He had run for 6 yards all year. He goes for 14 on that play, surprising the Grambling defense.
And following their best offensive lineman, number 62, the center, Wakwanisi Eugene. You see that gap right there. They just got him with the gash up the middle. When you talk about Eugene, their center, the coaching staff said he was so disappointed he was not named to the first or second team All-SWAC team, and they feel he's the best center in the conference.
Gives the block to Nelson, and now Mason gives the football to Lacey. Across the 35-yard line, gain of 2. We'll ring up 2nd and 8. Stop made by Antoine Rogers.
And on that dive play, I guarantee you that Grambling probably practiced that play, defensing that play, at least 5 times a day in practice, so they couldn't gash him for it. And then you get into the game condition, you got a running back that's running well in Lacey, and what happens? You start focusing on Lacey, and they sneak you with the fullback dive.
Doug Williams said early in the season, again, an offensive-minded guy trying to grow his defense through his offense in spring practice during the early season preseason practices and camps. Was trying to get this defense together with Cliff Yoshida at the helm. 4-yard pickup for Lacey to the 40-yard line. That'll bring up a 3rd and manageable situation. Mentioned Cliff Yoshida, 5th season, and a guy on that defensive coordinator spot for Grambling, former defensive coordinator at Wake Forest, former defensive coordinator at Duke, former defensive line coach at Virginia Tech, where he coached Bruce Smith. So, I mean, this is a guy that has some great experience.
Yeah, he coached at North Carolina A&T for a while as well, so he knows some defenses, and he's very active, and it's just been one of those years where even though, and we've seen it here today, the defense plays well in spurts, but once teams figure out a way to get to the secondary, it's been the secondary lapses that have really cost them.
Mason on 3rd and 4, and overthrows his intended target. He was looking for Gialonzo Milton. Edward Patterson in the coverage, so a good stand from Grambling. Didn't give up the big run play to Lacey, and they get the stop on 3rd down.
This is one of those games where, and this seems to be the trend for Alabama A&M when you cover them. They come out game plan, they do a great job, they get a lead on you, and then their offense just seems to stall a little bit in spurts. And that'll happen to the best teams, but if Grambling can just put the pressure on there to score and really put some pressure on Alabama A&M, then you're just a turnover away from really seizing control of this football game.
Wilson to Stuckman from the 26. He lost the football, and the Bulldogs may have it. Stuckman never really got a good hold of it. And for Alabama A&M, Vandrick Jackson came storming in. Jordan Roman came in. He's the holder and trying to jump on the ball as well.
By the kicking team. 1st and 10.
And indeed, Trennis Livingston confirms it. Stuckman couldn't hold on, and the Bulldogs take over.
Well, you know, one thing about Stuckman, he doesn't really believe in calling fair catches. We saw in the very first punt, he took a pop there. So his tendency is to field the ball first, try and make a guy miss, but you don't field it cleanly. Good job of separating Stuckman from the football on the bobble, and the Bulldogs make a huge play on special teams.
Demario Ross, Vandrick Jackson, both came in to try to jump on top of it. Short field for Mason. Lacey has it on 1st and 10, and he will get nothing.
Once again, this Grambling State defense being tested. Special teams let them down. They've already bent in terms of giving the Bulldogs great field position, but will they break? Can they force 3 plays and out right now, which would be a huge spark for the offense, and potentially a game-changing moment right now in this football contest.
Eczema, the co-defensive player of the year, trying to help out this defense come up with a much-needed stop. Another turnover. That's 2 on the day for Grambling State. They've had 12 in their last five games. Their turnover margin has been minus 12 in the last five games. Screen thrown out to Montarius Smith. 44th catch of the season. He's been one of the top targets, the top target for Deontay Mason this year. Just a three-yard pickup, and it'll bring up third and seven.
And this is one of those areas where Alabama A&M lacks. When Grambling State gets the ball this part of the field, they need a big play. We know their go-to guy is Mario Lewis. Who's the go-to wide receiver for Alabama A&M? They kind of play wide receiver by committee.
Right.
Ben Montarius Smith, but he's got 43 catches, and we haven't really heard from him yet, and we haven't called his name today.
And Smith does not have a touchdown despite leading the team in catches this year.
So they're daring. The middle field's wide open.
Right.
They've got nobody back here. If you can get somebody in that second level, you can hit them for a big play.
Grambling bringing the house. They bring pressure. Mason lets it fly. He was looking for Milton. Coverage there from a linebacker in Trey Williams, who again came in the first quarter for the injured Cedric Goins. Fourth and seven.
It's when you get looks like that, when they say, we're going to play man-to-man coverage everywhere, force you to throw the ball. That's when, as a quarterback, you have to have that deep threat go-to wide receiver. And that seems to be what they're lacking right now at Alabama A&M. And once again, Grambling State defense has risen to the occasion to force a field goal attempt from Alabama A&M.
And he made one from 34 yards. This one will be from 41 for Chance Wilson. He's made seven consecutive. Three for four on field goals above 40. It's going to be a pooch punt instead. Wilson, who is the punter, will lob one down.
Didn't work.
Give Grambling the field position at the 20.
Net 4 yards on that pooch punt attempt there.
Anthony Jones with maybe a surprise move. Grambling has it at the 20.
Third and goal, Ken the Pack.
ESPNU College Football is brought to you by the Lexus December to Remember sales event for a limited time at your Lexus dealer. The Magic City, Birmingham, Alabama. We've got just about the same view from our broadcast booth at Legion Field. The view for the Grambling fans is of 3 points so far in 2.5 quarters. Tigers have the football at their own 20-yard line. Down a dozen, 7 minutes left in the third. DJ Williams, the true freshman, the son of Doug Williams, the head coach, and the Super Bowl MVP, takes over and takes a home run shot. Mario Lewis has it. Mario Lewis, see you later. 80-yard touchdown.
We talked about him being a game breaker, and give your big play receiver an opportunity. When they need a score, they go to Mario Lewis. 18th touchdown grab on the season. Now, what a tremendous route here. You see the play action. He's got time to throw. Watch Lewis readjust for the ball. Ball's down the middle. Go get it. Extend with the hands. Take it to pay dirt. He's a real deal, Adam.
Former high school basketball player wanted to walk on at Grambling. This is going to be a problem for Fabian Carter, who cannot hold on. Another missed extra point in this game. The usually sure-handed Carter unable to hold on to the snap. So Grambling has missed its only extra point try. A&M has missed both of its extra point tries today. But Doug Williams finally gets the touchdown that he was hoping for from his son.
Yeah, with the middle of the field wide open, no free safety help there. You've got your cornerback on an island, and that's a matchup they've been trying to get to, with Derek Harris just not able to come up with the stop. And that's a big play when they really needed it the most. The offense was stalling. They've been stalling all day. And Mario Lewis comes up with the 18th touchdown grab of the year from 80 yards to the house.
Longest play of the season for Grambling. Longest throw for Williams. Longest catch for Lewis. Who again was found on the intramural football field before his junior season. And they brought him out to play football at Grambling State. He was hoping to be a walk-on to the basketball team. Did not play football in high school at all. He was a basketball player. And Doug Williams, when we spoke to him at the beginning of the season, he said, I want Mario Lewis to be a leader on this team. He's a senior. I know he's only been around for a year, but I want him to be a leader. And he said Lewis absolutely has filled that role with big plays like that to finally get a touchdown for Grambling State. Montarius Smith, a foot deep into the end zone. don't even get to the 15-yard line. Very short return, and maybe the Grambling State defense is energized by their offense on that 80-yard touchdown with 6:47 to go in the third. Tonight, when the Heisman Trophy is awarded, you can see it on ESPN, but afterwards, ESPNU has continuing coverage at 9 p.m. Reaction from analysts, coaches, and more from the winner of the prestigious award. Then, of course, at 3 a.m., you'll see a replay of the top performance from the Heisman winner this season. Heisman live tonight at 9 Eastern on ESPNU. RG3's my pick. Andrew Luck, you said, is your pick.
Yeah, my pick, and, you know, when it asks for us, too, because I can very easily see Trent Richardson doing something as well, too. I mean, the one loss on the season that Alabama had, he played well in that LSU game. And the Honey Badger, big fan of the Honey Badger. I mean, he had the most Heisman moments in his season.
I agree.
Without question.
A long field to work with. Lacey and Beatty are the backs. Beatty will get the handoff, or the play fake, rather. It's a quick throw over the middle and a first down catch. Naquan Smith finally stuck Kadarius Lacey, who is very slow to get up, and you do not see this often from Kadarius Lacey, the big bruiser. You do see that often, though, getting up. He will shake it off.
Yeah, kind of got the wind knocked out of him. You see he's going to go up and get this ball. They lined him up in the fullback position, and ball throw behind him, and nice delivery of putting the shoulder pad right into the stomach area by Bruno Foster.
It was Foster on the hit. Smith was late getting there. Lacey will have to step out for a play.
That's why you got to love the game of football. See, earlier we saw Lacey just run through Foster.
That's right.
Foster,
yes,
gets an opportunity to deliver some wood on Lacey, and he did it in between the whistles. Payback.
Well, Beatty is in the backfield as the deep back. They'll go to Nelson again. He had that 14-yard run earlier in this quarter, and he'll pick up six here. How about that? 20 yards on the day for Nelson, who had just six total yards all season on the ground. You see Grambling getting that touchdown from Mario Lewis. 80 yards on the last play. They did less than that on their first eight touches of the football all day.
Now they found a little bit of momentum, and can the defense rise to the occasion? We talked about putting Alabama A&M in pressure situations where they must score. Well, now this is that situation. Can the Grambling State defense rise to the challenge?
Load up the wide side. Woo! Smith gets stuck hard. Edward Patterson for a loss of four.
We saw it earlier. He gets that running start. Great recognition. Just a sprint to the ball carrier. Edward Patterson coming off the numbers. You'll see him right here, number 40. Watch the recognition. Watch him explode. Watch the big hit. Sees it. Recognize. Boom! Hello.
That screen just has not worked to Smith, because Patterson has been there to blow it up a couple of times today. The junior from Monroe, Louisiana, bringing up a very big third down for this Grambling defense. Bulldogs need the 38. Play clock was running down. But Anthony Jones get the timeout. May have to check with the side
game. Offense, number 11. 5-yard penalty. Remain third down.
It goes to third and 13. Jones cannot get the timeout.
Oh, for the first time, you're starting to hear life from the sidelines and the fans of Grambling State. They're into it. They think they've got the Bulldogs on the ropes.
Turnovers have been a killer for Grambling State. Can they maybe come up with one deep in A&M territory? As the Bulldogs are struggling on third down today. They need the 38. Pressure coming on Mason. Rolling out to the right. Big time catch, Montarius Smith. He may have made the catch in front of the first down marker. It looked like he did. Patterson came flying in to put another big hit on Smith, and they're going to say he's short.
That's a bad spot. I mean, he gets rocked back 4 yards, but look where he catches the ball, about on the 39-yard line.
That's at least a yard past the first down marker.
And they mark him on the 37-yard line. They took 2 yards from him. That's a tough one.
The line judge Jesse Harris came rushing out to talk to Trentus Livingston. I mean, this is a 4th-and-2 situation on a play where likely you would spot Smith probably at the 39.5 at the very least.
Yeah, and you see the catch right there. He's got the ball. And about the 39 is when he makes the catch.
Third play is under review.
I wonder if the question being, can you challenge the forward progress?
Yes.
So if it's something to do with the first down, maybe you can.
The rule, and I do remember this from a previous game earlier in the season, you cannot review forward progress, but you did make a great point. On a first down play, you should be able to because it impacts the sticks.
Yeah, I agree. And you see right there, he's clearly past the sticks right there when he makes the catch. Gets a foot down on the ground, too, which I think will be key. So leaves his feet there. Has the ball, catches it cleanly, gets a foot down on around the 38.5 yard line. So I think at the very least you could say that's a point of contact
right
where he came down.
Again, you can challenge a spot. You cannot challenge forward progress, but unless it's a first down play, you can at least get a review. This is an official review. The ruling on the field was short. Trennis Livingston, what do you got?
After further review, the receiver possessed the ball at the 39-yard line. Will result in a 1st and 10. 1st and 10, Alabama A&M.
Well, Smith got hit hard by Patterson on that screen a couple of plays before, but he hung on to that football and was past the first down marker on a 3rd and long. Mason connects with Smith to move the sticks.
Yeah, what a good job by Deontay Mason of extending the play on one leg. That just proves you don't have to be the fastest runner. You just have to be an efficient runner that can move comfortably in the pocket. He bought that extra split second, allowing the receiver to get open, and was rewarded with the first down conversion.
Remember SWAC bringing in the review for this championship game. That's exactly the reason you have replay review. Did not have it this season, but did bring it in for the SWAC title game, and it has come up with the right call a couple of times today. Kadarius Lacy is back into the game. Remember, he got the wind knocked out of him a couple of plays ago. They did not have him on that 3rd down and long, but he is back into the game.
That was a huge 3rd down conversion.
Absolutely.
There. Grambling fans were getting into it. The defense was feeling good. They had some momentum, and now kind of silent the crowd a little bit and give you an opportunity to establish that running game.
Resetting the chains and making sure the clock is correct as well. On the first down, you do need to stop it. Now the ready signal, the clock continues to move. They had to reset it to about 4:20, so they added about 10 seconds on the clock. As Lacy on first down will get wrapped up by Jamarcus Savage after a gain of 5. So now we near 4 minutes to go here in this 3rd quarter. Alabama A&M trying to win its first SWAC title since 2006. It would be its 2nd. Grambling trying to pick up its 6th SWAC championship. This is the 4th time that these two teams have met in a SWAC title game. Grambling has won all 3. 2nd and 5 for Mason Lacy and the Bulldogs. Lacy switching sides, leaning to the left to pick it up 4. Close to the first down marker. Savage there again for another stop.
There was a point during the Magic City Classic when Alabama A&M was holding on to a 1-point lead versus Alabama State.
Right.
Alabama State had gained momentum. A&M responded with a 10-12 play drive that ate up 6 minutes on the clock. And you can tell when things get tough on the Bulldogs, they get it to Kadarius Lacy and allow him to carry the weight on his shoulders. And it seems no different right now.
3rd and short yardage. Let's see if they go to Lacy. Nelson is in front of him. Delayed handoff. The Tigers are there defensively. Naquan Smith, Cliff Eczema. 2nd time those two have come up with a big 3rd down stop today.
When they bring Naquan Smith close to the line of scrimmage, they expect him to make a tackle to force things inside. Great upfield penetration, forces Lacy to go inside, and there to wrap him up is Cliff Eczema, the defensive player of the year from the SWAC Conference.
Smith, a guy who didn't get as much credit as he deserved, Doug Williams said. He's done some good things today. Wilson punts it away. Kenneth Batiste is back to return a punt. We'll have no return. It'll be a 33-yard punt near the 25-yard line is where Grambling takes over, fresh off a touchdown and a stop.
The most extensive Heisman Trophy coverage.
Great legacy of wonderful quarterbacks that played in the SWAC. Maybe none better than Steve McNair, whose life obviously ended tragically. But McNair really was the class of the SWAC. You go back a little further, Doug Williams, the head coach of Grambling, took over as a true freshman in 1974, about five games into the season. And that leads us to our Facebook question, facebook.com/ESPNU, along with Doug and Steve and Shaq Harris, who we got to meet with a little bit earlier today. Who do you put along with those three on the Mount Rushmore of great SWAC quarterbacks? facebook.com/ESPNU. Jay?
Now, I think we should name that Jay's Mount Rushmore SWAC quarterback.
Jay's
so,
Mount Rushmore.
You know, Mount Rushmore, you've got four faces, and I think, you know, James, Shaq Harris, first guy from Grambling to play in the NFL, one of the first African-American quarterbacks in the NFL, period. Legend Doug Williams, we know his accomplishments. Steve McNair, but there's a list of some other SWAC legends. Some great ones throughout the years. I'm sure Tavares Jackson.
Sure.
Would be one of those guys you mentioned. Robert Kent, Bruce Eugene.
Bruce Eugene is now back at Alcorn State. Tavares was the MVP of this championship game in 2004.
So I want to hear from him. Tell me who you think it should be. I know I'm leaving some off. You got, oh, wow, talk about, you know, Ricky Jones played Alabama State, led them to an undefeated team, one of the best teams ever to come through the SWAC. There have been some good ones. That's the one thing I like about the SWAC. They've got these QB legends that everybody knows about, and they put up some phenomenal numbers. We're just talking about throwing the ball.
All right, Doug Williams put up career numbers at the time, NCAA records for his career in yards and touchdowns. Took over as a true freshman starter in his first year, just like DJ has this season. Third and four for DJ Williams. What a stick by Vernon Marshall. Batiste out of the backfield making the grab, shy of the first down marker. Marshall came in hard.
And we talked about Marshall being an outside linebacker playing the cornerback position. Good job by Bronski Towns of putting Marshall in some cover two, where he's responsible for the outside force, able to easily identify the ball carrier, make the tackle. They're really doing a good job schematically. When you're down in your secondary, you don't want to have your linebackers covering one-on-one. Play some nice soft cover two and allow them to come up and be solid form tacklers.
Fabian Carter set to kick to Montarius Smith. Longest return has been 29 this year. This from the 21. Good open field tackle by Tyree Hollins in special teams. A 49-yard punt, a 5-yard return. DJ Williams unable to do anything at the end of the third quarter. But the Tigers have scored on two of their last four possessions. They're back in this game. It's a 6-point A&M lead through three. SWAC title game, 13th annual, coming up to the fourth quarter.
Baylor.
ESPN's presentation of college football on ESPNU presented by McDonald's. A&M with a 15-9 lead going into the fourth quarter on Grambling State. A&M really leaned on Kadarius Lacy early in this ball game. They had that solid lead with Lacy at the helm.
Yeah, opening drive, they made it look simple. He had his way, but then you had a couple of the miscues there, not converting on the extra point, getting it blocked there. And then they got Terrence Pride involved, getting the ball to the end zone. Lacy running the ball really opened things up for the passing game. Another mixed extra point, which I think at some point will loom large in this contest if Grambling can get it down to a 3-point game at least or less. And then you saw the big playability of Mario Lewis showing you why he led the nation in touchdown receptions this season.
Longest play of the season, an 80-yard touchdown pass to Lewis. But A&M has the 6-point lead. Mason on first down, rolling on play fake. Montarius Smith spinning at the 45 with a solid gain on first down. 19-yard pickup to Smith, who's made some good catches today. And another Tiger is down. It's Naquan Smith clutching his left knee. This has been a Tiger defense that's gotten banged up today. They already lost Cedric Goins to a leg injury early in this game, and Smith, who's been so good today, is down.
Yeah, he's been their active guy around the line of scrimmage, slowing down the running game. And You see, if you can get the ball in the secondary, look at that. I mean, you got three guys, and they barely touch him. You'll see 26 right there, and you see right there on that turf, knee just goes and gets caught up pretty bad. And don't think. That's bad news right there. That's one of those ones when you see it, very doubtful he'll be able to come back in this football contest.
We're missing Dominic Bell, who's dealing with an injury as well. Smith has been great this year, but he is down. We'll step aside.
Next Gear is reinventing the best-selling car in America.
Naquan Smith, the fine safety who has made great plays all day for Grambling's defense, is out. Tended to his left knee. It's a six-point game, and this is how these two teams have squeaked in at points this year. Five of Grambling's seven and five of A&M's eight wins have been one-possession wins this year. Darius Lacy with nowhere to go. Big stop from Trey Williams, who also came in for an injured player in Cedric Goins early in this ball game. So a nice play by Williams for a loss of two. We're talking with Jay Walker about this, his Mount Rushmore of SWAC quarterbacks: Doug Williams, James Harris, Steve McNair. Who's your fourth? Facebook.com/ESPNU.
Yeah, voting's closed. Voting's closed.
Okay.
I figured out who it is. Satellite. Satellite. You know who Satellite is?
You told me about Satellite before.
Willie Satellite Totten. You talk about an NCAA record holder. And for those of you all who don't know, there's a reason why Jerry Rice was drafted in the first round of the NFL. And Willie Satellite Totten had a lot to do with it.
An off-target throw from Deontay Mason on second and 12. Patterson was lunging for it. Third and long.
I always love that name, Satellite. I mean, is that the sweetest name you can have as a quarterback?
Well, in the SWAC, Satellite, they've got this great legacy of just great nicknames that are almost a sign of respect for the quarterbacks that receive them.
Yes. I mean, you talk about, you know, Satellite, and then you've got Shaq, which is nicknamed Sugar Shaq Harris, right, what they used to call him. Doug. I mean, that's like a nickname, just Doug.
Third and 12 for Doug's defense. Big play early in the fourth quarter. Deontay Mason spreads him out. Play clock got down to four. This is what we were talking about a moment ago, some of the great nicknames.
Oh, you put a list together on
That's
me.
Right.
Okay.
We got Aaron McNair, World Rice. There is Willie on the list, and of course, nobody can forget Sweetness, who had those great years at Jackson State.
I'll give you a little footnote. It was Steve Air to McNair.
Okay.
His brother was the first heir, Fred. Fred Air McNair was Steve Air to McNair, Shaq Harris. But I will tell you, to me, the greatest nickname of all time, besides Sky, there was a quarterback at Tennessee State, and his nickname was the Lord's Prayer. Everybody called him Lord's Prayer. Eldridge Dickey, the Lord's Prayer. You know what they said? Your prayers have been answered when he showed up on game day.
Mason waiting for a third and 12. I believe they had to reset the clock one more time. I think the clock was moving after an incomplete pass, so the clock was reset. Mason on third down, and Grambling is going to come up with another stop. David Stuckman coming out on Gialonzo Milton. And that'll force a fourth down.
The weakness of this Grambling secondary is not 1 to 5 yards downfield. It's in that second level. The secondary throws 10 yards plus. They tend to blow coverages and leave guys running wide open. They chose to attack underneath and allow the wide receiver to try and make a defender miss, but not in that case there.
Batiste back to return. Batiste has a kick return in his career for a touchdown against Alabama A&M. Did that last year. Does not have a punt return for a touchdown in his career.
Well, that's returnable if he can catch it cleanly.
That's a second bobble, but he runs to pick it up. He lost it again. And the Bulldogs have it again. Denzel Cotton comes out with a football, a disastrous mistake from Kenneth Batiste.
Unfortunate, too, because on a low line drive punt like that, if he could field it cleanly, The defense was nowhere around. He had days of running room. If he catches that cleanly, I understand why you do it. He could split the crease, and that could have been a big return. The mistake was he tried to pick it up the second time rather than just falling on the football.
Third Tiger turnover of the day, one from Batiste, one from Stuckman, both on returns. And that turnover margin continues to go south.
And these are miscues that you normally do not find in teams competing for championships. And it's been a problem all season long, and it's hurting them here today in Birmingham.
Short field for Kadarius Easy, trying to get to the edge. Good pursuit by Brune Foster, a loss of one. A much needed stop from Foster out of the safety spot.
And that's a good matchup to watch him go. Earlier, Lacey got the best of Foster. Foster, ever since then, has been right on point. Foster's a big kid, too, playing that free safety position at 6'1", 230 pounds. So you've got 230 taking on 230. No wonder there have been some collisions between those two in the hole.
And their defense has kept them in this ball game, as it has at times this season. They've only really had one dominant defensive performance. That was their last game against Southern. Go back to the fullback, Nelson. That's
Bumble.
A third carry, and he lost the football. Tigers have it. Jacardi Carter on the run, down the sideline. Nobody in front of him. Can he get the block from Stuckman? Yes! Touchdown! Oh! We've got a new ball game in Birmingham with a SWAC title on the line.
Big hit, high in the hole. Great job of pulling him away from the football. Then it became a foot race. Jacardi Carter with the little entourage, one-man entourage with David Stuckman there. And look out, the G-men have arrived in Birmingham, Alabama.
And Zoltan Riazzo with a chance to put the Tigers in front for the first time today.
Keep in mind, their only touchdown they scored earlier, they missed the extra point. So this extra point is no gimme for Grambling.
There has not been a made extra point today on either side. Hold from Carter. This time he's solid. And the Tigers have jumped in front in Birmingham. We said their defense has kept them in games all season. Sure enough, loose ball, Carter has it. And Carter goes all the way home. And the Tigers are in front in the championship game. ESPNU College Football is presented by McDonald's. I'm loving it. Back in Birmingham, Alabama, and we've got a brand new ball game. 16 unanswered points for Grambling, and the last seven came off of a turnover, a takeaway, a loose ball from Brian Nelson, the fullback, who had not carried the ball more than twice all season. His third carry of this game ends in a fumble. Carter picks it up and takes it to the house to tie the game. The extra point is good. There were two penalties on the extra point. They were offsetting. Point after touchdown is good, and the Tigers have the lead.
And they've got a defense with confidence that's going back onto the field.
Naquan Smith, the injured safety, who may be done for the rest of the game, meeting Jacardi Carter. Smith had made some big plays all game long. They didn't have Smith the rest of the ball game, dealing with a left knee injury. Carter filled that void for a big defensive play, taking it all the way home. Terrence Pride bobbles it, has to take it out.
Bad decision.
Pride barely to the 10-yard line, gets thrown down. He may have touched it outside of the end zone. And that's why he may have had to actually bring that out when he did step back into the end zone.
And if you got that gray area, then you're taught to bring it, go ahead and bring it out. But right now, you got some hungry Tigers over there on defense.
That's
you
right.
Can tell they're flying around the field, even on special teams, playing with their first lead today. This is what you call championship time right now. If you're Alabama A&M and you want to win the SWAC crown in 2011, go out and get it right now. One-point lead is not a tough task.
How about this from Kadarius Lazy, 74 yards on the day, but he has done nothing the last seven touches of the football. And another long field for A&M. They've got 90 yards to go. They'll go back to Lacy. Squirts ahead through a very tight seam for a three-yard pickup. Antonio Leonard tripped him up a little bit. Antonio Leonard, a second-team All-SWAC selection a year ago, the transfer from Southern Miss.
Now, the key right now is going to be Tyler Smith. Backup free safety, filling in for Naquan Smith at that strong safety position. If they're going to try and run the football, if you're Graham, you're going to need Tyler Smith to make plenty of tackles around the line of scrimmage to take on Kadarius Lacy. We saw Naquan Smith did a great job doing it. Can Tyler Smith do the same?
There he is. And he does at least deter Lacy and throws him into Jacardi Carter. It is a pickup of 3 yards.
And they had some help there, but it was a good job by Smith of filling the hole, lowering that shoulder pad, getting a nice thud on him.
Tyler Smith playing in just his seventh game this season, trying to stop the freight train known as Kadarius Lacy. Well, third and four coming up. And Lacy off the field on this third down as Mason will spread out five receivers from the 16-yard line. And he gets the first down. Rashad DeJarnett. Remember, had that big touchdown against Texas Southern. He's really been quiet since that game. His first catch of the day, but it is a first down grab.
And DeJarnett realizes you make a big play like that, you don't want to be known as a one-hit wonder. You've got to make continual big plays during the season. Learning experience for DeJarnett.
Deontay Mason got sacked against Prairie View A&M, ended up twisting his left knee, dealt with an MCL sprain, and leave that game. A&M did win to get its record up to 7-2 in conference play. They do get in to the SWAC title game. Mason dealing with that left knee problem, leaning on Lacy, but Lacy will get nothing. Trey Williams, another backup. We talk about the backups. They're trying to make big plays, and he's the first one to beat Lacy there. It's a loss of a yard.
Yeah, and they're really doing a good job of containing the Alabama A&M running game. They're really telling them there won't be any bounce back lanes. If you think you're going to have the ability to flash and bounce to the outside, that's when they've got Smith waiting for you, or they've got Trey Williams that have been waiting there for you. Haven't called Cliff Exuma's name a lot because they've been trying to bounce the ball to the outside, and that's why the safety and the outside linebackers have been making a bulk majority share of the tackles for Grambling.
Second and 11. Mason with pressure coming. That ball knocked down by Jamarcus Savage. He had an opportunity. Rogers was bringing the heat. Savage got a hand on it. Third and long.
Trying to do a quick release, one of those wide receiver screens, and great recognition by Savage. He over-anticipated the play. He left his feet when he didn't have to. But those are the natural instincts of a defensive lineman. When a quarterback releases that ball, elevate, get off your feet.
A&M has scuffled on third down today. They've got a long distance to go. They need the 30-yard line here with the transfer from Kentucky. Mason out of the shotgun. Four-man rush and a whistle will stop this play. It's maybe a false start against A&M.
False start. Offense created. Five-yard penalty. Remain third down.
Torrey Smith, one of the receivers, moved a little quickly.
Good look there, Coach Anthony Jones. And think about the body of work he's been able to accomplish at Alabama A&M. 10 years there, two losing seasons there. And when they lose, they don't have these 2-9 campaigns. I mean, they're losing seasons for them, 4-7, 5-6. Really rebounded well this season to get this team to the championship game, and oh so close to finalizing the season with the championship.
A turnaround from a 2-7 conference here last year. Third and 16. Mason running out of room, running out of time, still on the move. And
wow.
Did a foot get in bounds? It did. Gialonzo Milton down the sideline.
How do you do this if you're David Stuckman, the defensive back? looking in the backfield at the quarterback. True, it's a long time to cover wide receiver. Watch number two on the left side of your screen. He's just going to give up on the play and then just jump. And a great job by Gialonzo Milton of getting his feet in bounds and a huge third down conversion.
Forget 1 foot, he got two for 32 yards. Moving it all the way down to the 46-yard line. Terrell Beatty is the back. Lacy gets a blow. Delayed handoff. Beatty lost it. Jump back on top of it. Hine is fighting with him for it, but it's a loss of one. Beatty did hold on to the football.
This is on the quarterback running back exchange. Very fortunate for the Bulldogs to get that football back. But how big was that third down conversion by Mason? Buying time.
At worst, if you go three and out on this new set of downs, your field position is much better defensively.
Yes.
At worst.
That was definitely a game-changing play there by the junior from Nashville.
Quick throw, Milton into Grambling territory on second and 10. Only about 4 yards, 5 yards shy of the first down.
It looks like now what you're starting to see Alabama A&M do when they throw the ball is they're looking for Stuckman. When we talked to Doug Williams earlier, he said it was during that Prairie View A&M game that Prairie View found Stuckman. You know, you say you found a defensive back. Well, Stuckman's 5'6", 160 pounds, doesn't have a big size frame. Only so many things he can do to hurt you. And now it seems like when they're going to throw the football, they're going to go in the direction of David Stuckman, number two. He's got to step up and make a big play.
And a big third down coming here. Mason pumps. Flushed out. Pressure still coming. Mason will get rid of the football. And instead, it will be a fourth down. Bulldogs will punt it away halfway home in the fourth quarter. Mason just had nothing down the field.
They tried to go with the double move there after setting them up on the previous play with the short pass. This time the Tiger defense stayed back in coverage.
Got something for you, and I ask you this. We talk about A&M being able to burn clock. Grambling is pretty good at burning clock, too. Their last game against Southern, for the final 8 minutes of the game, they ran a wing T formation. They've got a one-point lead and 7.5 to go. Do you do that here?
I would not be surprised if they tried it. You know, interesting to see how they play with the lead. They've been trailing all game long. Now that you've got the lead, game plan changes a little bit.
Boy, the handling of kicks has been bad for Grambling, and Chance Wilson will do the Tigers a favor, kicking that one out of bounds. A 27-yard punt. A&M on defense, down one. Tigers have it with 7:22 to go when you come back.
The Men's College Cup Championship game. Tomorrow at 4 on ESPNU.
Off with Mary Wise's Florida Gators. Women's NCAA Volleyball Championships presented by Enterprise Rent-A-Car. DJ Williams with a handoff to Dorrance Roberts, who's been relatively quiet today. He loses the football. And it looked like Denzel Cotton may have jumped back on top of it. The Bulldogs looking for another turnover. They're down by one. But it was O'Shea Hamilton who has his second fumble recovery on a Grambling fumble today. The fullback able to jump back on top of it. So under 7 minutes to go. The first offensive play of the fourth quarter for Grambling. It does end up in a half dozen yard pickup. It's their fourth fumble of the day. They have lost a couple on returns, but none of Roberts' miscues have been turned over. Batiste is back in as Roberts takes a seat on the sideline, and a timeout for Grambling with 6:34 to go. We talked about the Women's Volleyball Championships coming up tonight. Tomorrow, ESPNU's coverage of the Men's College Cup continues. 4 Eastern, the Cinderella story of the tournament. Charlotte scoring off with top-ranked North Carolina. NCAA Men's College Cup presented by Enterprise Rent-A-Car on ESPNU tomorrow. Rob Stone, Taylor Twellman seeing a couple of double overtime matches that both ended in penalty kicks last night. Alabama A&M down by one, 6:31 to go. Tigers have a second and 4 coming up. There have been some key plays over the course of this season for Alabama A&M. This was in the Magic City Classic. Chartavius Keith coming up with that clutch block. Devin Dominguez just ran a touchdown from 60 yards out to make it a 20-19 game. Bulldogs blocked that kick. Today, a couple of missed extra points on a Grambling block and one off the upright from Chance Wilson. So they're missing 2 points off the board right now. It could be 17 for A&M at this point. They go back to Torrance Roberts, and he'll work past the first down marker, a 6-yard pickup. He moves the sticks. 6:24 to go. This is what we talked about. These two teams, at least A&M is known for being able to burn clock, but Dorrance Roberts is the guy they've found to be able to run the ball to move the clock.
He can run the ball very effectively, but right now, ball security is at a must. He's got to be able to hold on to the football. This unit as a whole has struggled with ball security throughout the season. It's a new season in the championship game. See if they can learn from their mistakes and protect the football.
Two fumbles today for Roberts, but neither has been lost. Three fumbles, and he jumps back on top of that one. Boy, the Tigers are just playing with fire right now.
I mean, very, very dangerous. I mean, you know, some people are watching saying they just don't understand how Grambling's winning this football game at all. And then you put on top of that the number of times the ball has been on the turf for them. That's just not a clean exchange. You've got to put that ball right in the belly. And I think that's a combination of a young runner and a young quarterback in pressure situations.
Those two have combined for 17 fumbles this season. Again, they have not lost any fumbles today between those two. Second and 12, and this is what Bronski Towns wanted to do, stack the box. He sends the pressure. Williams fires. Diving attempt incomplete. He was looking for Lewis. Could not stick a foot inbounds, and it's third and long for the Tigers.
I mean, this is what you want. One-on-one with your go-to wide receiver. That's great separation right there. Whoa! That knee was out. Did that foot tap out before he went out of bounds?
There is Bronski Towns, defensive coordinator for Alabama A&M, a 33rd year at Alabama A&M. Defensive coordinator for nearly two decades, came to A&M in 1965 to play for Lewis Cruz. Still has the school record for career interceptions with 29.
And when things get tight, Towns is going to bring some pressure.
They'll go to Batiste on third and long. And Grambling, after a gain of four there, will kick this one away. Melvin Payne on the stop. So A&M will have a chance with all three timeouts and under 5 minutes to go to try to come from behind and win this game.
And they should get the ball with pretty decent field position and good opportunity to set up a return for your punt return unit.
Montarius Smith hasn't been a big punt returner this season. He is back at his own 20 with Carter getting set to kick it away. Smith at the 12. He lost the football. Still loose on the ground. Tigers may have it. Wade Julian, the freshman, jumped on top of it. Did he keep the possession? The Tigers and Bulldogs being ripped out of that pile. Trennis Livingston and the officiating crew trying to sort it all out.
57 just left the pile. He did not come away with that football. I think the Bulldogs are going to keep it.
Boy, nearly disastrous for Montarius Smith. That's the eighth combined fumble in this game. But Montarius Smith jumped back on top of it. And at the 23-yard line, A&M, three timeouts, 4:11 to go, down one.
Burning out this useless telephone.
Hair is gone.
Cheap cologne.
Motorhome. Volleyball NCAA tournament, that's coming up at 4:30. Adam?
Final 4:12 to go in the fourth. You got to look at Anthony Jones on the left, Doug Williams on the right. Those two were roommates the night before Super Bowl 22 for the Washington Redskins. Doug Williams had a root canal that day, so not a ton of conversation the night before Super Bowl 22. But the next day, Williams went out, became the MVP of Super Bowl 22 in a rout of the Denver Broncos. He and Anthony Jones have been very good friends the last 25 years, and they're squaring off in the SWAC title game, which is a one-point game right now. Alabama A&M down a point with the football. They go to Kadarius Lacy. Solid run near the 30-yard line before David Stuckman got to him. It's a pickup of 7 yards. Bulldogs have 4 minutes and all three timeouts, and a quarterback at their helm that has engineered 4 game-winning drives this season.
He's been playing this whole championship game on just one leg, hobbling along, Deontay Mason. This is the point in the game where you're not trying to outsmart anybody. Put your best out there against my best. Heavy dose of Kadarius Lacy in this drive to see if he can get him in field goal range to win a championship.
Mason will keep it. This is the first time he's ran up the middle today. He's got the first down near the 35-yard line. We said, how is he going to react mentally today? That was going to be more of a concern than necessarily the physical aspect. That shows a little mental toughness from Mason there.
He's been toughing it out all game long, realizing they've got Lacy covered. I've got to pull the ball in. And it was just a matter of his comfort level. Does he have the confidence in that knee, which he hurt earlier during the season, to trust it? And I think as the game's progressed, he started to trust that left knee more and more.
Chance Wilson's field goal range, his longest this season and the longest of his career, is 49 yards, so about the 32, 31 yard line. Mason slings one for a catch. What a play by Smith. Down to the 40 yard line, a 23 yard strike.
The secondary of Grambling continues to be the Achilles heels. You don't allow slot receivers to run this wide open down the field in your secondary. Bad things will happen. And great job by Monteri Smith climbing the ladder, coming down with a huge catch.
Don't forget that Naquan Smith is out of the game from the secondary for Grambling. They're banged up right now. First and 10 from the 40-yard line, very close to Wilson's field goal range.
Keep exploiting them in the passing in the secondary if it's hot.
2.5 to go. Mason has the pitch man if he wants it. He'll give it to Beatty. Beatty will get nothing. He'll lose a couple of yards. Cliff Eczema coming up with Tyler Smith, another backup in the game for Naquan Smith. They team up for the stop at a loss of 3.
Great job of stretching that option play out there. You see Chance Wilson. What a name. Chance Wilson. Do you think he hopes he gets a chance?
One of us had to say it. I'm glad it was.
He's probably hoping for a chance at an extra point before a field goal attempt.
And 2 missed extra points from Alabama A&M today. 1 block and 1 miss off the upright from Wilson. 2nd and long. Out of the backfield, Lacy. A yard past the original line of scrimmage as he stiff-arms Smith for a gain of 4. It'll be 3rd and 9 coming up, and Anthony Jones will use his first timeout.
They're going to need to get some yardage right now on this 3rd down play. Otherwise, it could be 2 down territory if they don't pick up some good yardage right here.
Don't forget tonight, the Heisman Trophy will be awarded in New York, and then afterwards, ESPNU with continuing coverage, including reaction from analysts, coaches, and, of course, the winner. Later tonight, you'll see on ESPNU at 3 a.m. the best performance from the winner this season. It's Heisman Live tonight at 9 Eastern on ESPNU. It'll come following the Heisman Trophy ceremony, which you can see on ESPN live from the Best Buy Theater in New York City. This is what is at stake in the final minute 45. Grambling, and again, this is to clarify, in the divisional play era with the championship game, in the 13-year history of the championship game, the Tigers looking for number 6, the Bulldogs looking for their 2nd, their 1st since 2006. And don't forget, Anthony Jones trying to do something that Alabama A&M hasn't done in 3 previous title games against Grambling, and that's beat them.
That's beat them, and keep in mind, there have only been 2 teams that have won multiple SWAC championships, and that's Grambling and Southern.
That's right.
If A&M can get the victory here today, they would join that group of teams with multiple SWAC titles.
Anthony Jones's team scored the first 15 points. The Tigers have scored the last 16. It's been a grind for both of these teams all season. 5-1 possession wins apiece. This is a 1-point game. This is a 3rd and 9. Tigers rush 4. Mason on the move. He needs the 30-yard line. He will be well short.
Not enough.
The clock continues to move. 90 seconds to go, and an injured Bulldog on the field back near midfield.
Yeah, we said he'd have to pick up a chunk of yardage, and I think he picked up 3 or 4 yards, but that's not going to be enough.
That's Alan Cruz. Right.
That's down on the field. But in the grand scheme of things in this football contest now, knowing Coach Jones the way he seems to have played things close to the vest all season long, I think this is going to be a pooch punt or a punt opportunity.
Might have to spend a timeout here due to the injury to Alan Cruz. It'd be the second timeout for Anthony Jones's team with the clock stopped at a minute 26. Cruz, the right tackle, the redshirt freshman from Huntsville, being helped up by the rest of his teammates. It's been a physical, in the trenches type of game. We've seen injuries on both sides. And Chance Wilson still awaiting an opportunity. This is, again, the ball's at the 36. That's about 4 or 5 yards shy, really, of Wilson's range. And Wilson's 49-yard field goal, that's a rarity. Remember from 41 when Wilson had an opportunity lining up for a field goal. They ended up pooch punting it. So not a ton of confidence for Wilson to go much beyond 45 yards.
Yeah, I mean, right now, if they go for it, it's a 50-plus-yard field goal. Now, the only saving grace they might have is he is kicking with the direction of the wind.
Right.
But I do think with a minute 25 to go, minute 26 to go, Grambling has 2 timeouts. You can't afford to have him miss this field goal and give the ball to Grambling in great field position where they only need, you know, 30-plus yards to go ahead and seal the deal or to ice the game.
The Bulldogs are facing that direction with the wind blowing towards that scoreboard. Ball's at the 36-yard line. It's a 4th-and-5 scenario.
So no punt. They're going for it.
They're going for it here. This is potentially the ball game right here. Biggest play of the night so far. They bring in Nelson.
I would look for a way to go deep routes, get into the secondary of Grambling State.
Mason rolling. He'll throw for the first down. It is picked off by Eczema. The defensive player of the year in the SWAC came up with the biggest defensive play of this year.
He got underneath the curl route. They were trying to go to Gialonzo Milton. As a linebacker, you're taught drop curl to flat. Great job by Cliff Eczema telling you why. I know what I'm doing. That's why I named him the impact player. It's not about the scouting reports. It's all about being a football player, making plays when called upon. Leading tackler in the SWAC conference this season, and what a great way to end his career with the potentially game-clinching interception here in the SWAC championship.
A&M does have 2 timeouts to work with. This ball game essentially is over in the arms of DJ Williams. A&M uses one of those 2 timeouts, a minute 16 to go. And Cliff Eczema graduated this past spring. Bachelor's in criminal justice. He wants to work into the law. Led this team in tackles for 3 consecutive seasons. 4th all-time in career FCS in tackles. And he comes up with his 2nd interception of the season. And it turns the ball over to the Tigers, who are a minute 16 away from the SWAC title.
And now keep in mind now, although Grambling's clearly in control, A&M does have 1 more timeout.
They do.
So you got to be getting your special teams ready right now for a punt return. If you can get a great punt return and set up another field goal attempt to possibly win this football contest.
They can stop the clock here. You can take a knee on what will be a 3rd down. They get the clock down to about 30 seconds.
Yeah, so they can get the ball back with some time on the clock. So right now, this is the time where you either go for punt block or punt return. But at the end of the day, if you're Alabama A&M, the key thing is you will have an opportunity to get your hands on the football one way or the other.
Following our game at 4:30 Eastern, the regional finals of the NCAA Women's Volleyball Championship presented by Enterprise Rent-A-Car, top-seeded Texas, ninth-seeded UCLA. Bruins with a win over Penn State yesterday, so that four-year run of national titles is over. Illinois, who is undefeated for a significant portion of this season, third seed will take on unseeded Florida. Mary Wise's Gators trying to work past the regional finals after they got bounced by Purdue last year. It's coming up at 4:30 after our ball game.
And I think Doug Williams realizes they'll get it back, so Grambling calls a timeout right now just to make sure they're on the same page.
Now, is that poor clock management there? Because you and I were kind of counting a little bit, and with a minute 20 to go, it's very close, especially with still two timeouts left. I wonder if maybe Doug thought that A&M had less timeouts than they really did, or no, I'm not sure why he necessarily thought that he could
I don't think that's the case.
Right, you
have to know your team.
Right.
And what's the problem that Grambling's had all season long?
Ball security.
Protecting the football. So you got here, you've got a young team, freshman quarterback, young running back. You try and run it, they strip them, fumble, and they get the ball back.
That's an excellent point to bring up.
I think what he's saying is we'll take a chance with our defense on the field. If we get some good special teams, play with the punt, cover the punt return, and that was the direction he's going to go.
And DJ Williams will take a knee at the 20. This clock will get down to about 35 seconds. You might end up using that final timeout if you're Grambling. Mario Lewis and this Tiger offense scoring 16 unanswered points. On the Tiger team scoring 16 unanswered points. And Lewis had a big six on an 80-yard touchdown pass from DJ Williams. He's the SWAC Championship Game Offensive MVP. Cliff Exuma is your SWAC Championship Defensive MVP. Those two have made clutch plays all season, and sure enough, they came up with two of the most clutch plays of this title game. Play clock down to two, down to one. They take the penalty here. No, they'll take the timeout. Tigers will use their final break of this game, about a half minute to go. And Montarius Smith is going to be back to return a Fabian Carter kick.
One thing I did notice about the Grambling punt team, they've got a left-footed kicker with a very strong leg, but it takes a long time for him to get the ball off. If you can rush him and put some pressure on him, you may get the block, or make him think that you're going to go for some pressure on him. He may shank one, and if he shanks one and you get the ball, let's say midfield, all you need is two or three first downs to give yourself a field goal, game-winning field goal opportunity.
Anthony Jones's defense has blocked four kicks this season. Theron Rice has two of them. Fabian Carter has only had one of his kicks blocked this season. He, remember, had a bobbled snap earlier in this ball game, but still got a punt off.
They were close to some earlier, and that was just with a moderate pass block, with a rush punt block.
Montarius Smith, his longest return is 29 yards this season. Eight-man rush. Carter gets it away. It gets hit hard. That might end the game. Smith, the fair catch at the 41, but that might end this ball game.
That's not going to be running into the kicker. And, you know, that I think that's going to be the 15-yard variety, which should seal it.
It does.
No. 15 yards, automatic, first down.
And Grambling State is your 2011 SWAC champion.
I mean, they had the punt they wanted. It wasn't a deep kick. The ball would have been fielded by Smith on the 40-yard line. He could have picked up 10 or 15 yards on the return. And if you a fan of Alabama A&M, you know what it goes back to? Two missed extra points.
It was Fabian Carter, and it was Theron Rice, who had blocked two of those kicks this season, running into the kicker, roughing the kicker. A personal foul, first down Grambling, victory formation, and the true freshman DJ Williams, maybe the most satisfying play of his season, as he wins a SWAC title for his dad, Doug. And the two friends who have been close since the 1980s, been friends for a quarter century, they meet at midfield. But Grambling State, the 2011 SWAC champion, are getting ready to give Doug Williams the Gatorade bath.
He sees it coming. They're holding him. Oh! The cold never felt so good.
The sixth championship in the divisional era for Grambling State. We welcome you to our Lexus HBCU post-game report. The first 15 points went to Alabama A&M. The final 16 scored by Grambling State. He's Jay Walker. I'm Adam Amin. What a game. I mean, this is what you wanted to see in a championship game. Exciting plays, clutch plays. Grambling State has won ugly during this now seven-game win streak en route to the SWAC championship. But in that stretch, they've been opportunistic. They've made those big plays when they've needed to make those big plays.
They had a defense that had that bend but don't break mentality. We thought it was going to be a cakewalk for Alabama A&M just running the football. But give credit to the Tigers. They made the adjustments. But when the offense could not move the ball downfield, they went to their big playmaker in Lewis, and he came up with the big play. And then the opportunistic defense, they came in here expecting to get a couple turnovers. And when they got the turnover, they seized the moment and the opportunity to give their offense the ball with the lead.
Jacardi Carter with the fumble recovery for a touchdown. The extra point made it a 16-15 Grambling State win, and the defense made the plays down the stretch to win the SWAC title in 2011. Coming up next, NCAA Women's Volleyball Regional Finals. Top-ranked Texas takes on UCLA. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For our wonderful ESPN production team all season, along with Jay Walker, Adam Amin sings so long from Birmingham, Alabama. Now let's get you out to NCAA Women's Volleyball, Texas and UCLA, with Holly Rowe and Jennifer Hoffman.